Greetings and congratulations on your successful download of this podcast episode. Before we commence with the discussion, please be advised of the possibility that offensive material may be expressed by our hosts at any given moment. Rest assured that they are people of fine character who have yet to be charged with a particular crime and harbour no ill will toward anyone. However, they are rather forthright in their opinions and capable of unpleasant language that may upset those of you with obviously superior moral standards. We value your interest in this podcast and hope to prevent such disgusting, filthy words causing you and your loved ones to scream in absolute terror, resulting in years of considerably expensive psychiatric therapy. And now, on with the episode.
Hello again, everyone. Welcome back to the second episode of Drunk Cinema.
Yeah, baby.
Yeah. I'm one of your co-hosts, Charles Skaggs, back in the Drunk Cinema Theater, ready to imbibe some adult beverages and watch a cinematic classic with my wonderful co-host and emotional support right now for yours truly.
I'm your emotional support animal.
Yeah, exactly. You're my emotional support animal. Xan Sprouse, how you doing, Xan?
I'm doing great, Charles. That'd be great. The next time we go out, I can wear a little vest, and you can say, don't touch her. She's working.
There you go.
She's working. Just give her a beer.
Yeah, exactly.
She's working.
Make her comfortable.
Yeah, exactly. Don't pet her. Don't pet her. She's on the job.
Xan gets what she wants, whether you like it or not.
Yeah. So, because I don't know if you noticed, but you're not supposed to pet a support animal.
Nope.
They're working. Yeah. Once that vest is on, they are all pros. It is just nothing but business.
So, everybody, I want to thank everyone who checked out our first episode
of
Drunk Cinema, Batman 1989. We had a lot of fun, as you could probably tell if you've listened to the episode. And if you haven't, I hope you go back and listen to it. But we got a lot of great feedback about it.
Awesome. I'm very excited about that.
Yeah. So hopefully, you know, you'll enjoy this one just as well as here at episode two, we are talking Ferris Bueller's Day Off.
Your ass is mine.
Yeah, we'll get there. We'll get there.
This is the first movie that I memorized completely. Les jeux sont faits.
Les jeux sont faits. Les jeux sont faits.
Translation, the game is up.
Your ass is mine. Then she spins around and spits her soda at him.
What's the score? Nothing. Who's winning?
The Bears.
Bears.
Yeah. So you know what we're in for.
And it's a baseball game.
Yeah. So this is, again, this is another movie that we talk a lot about on Ghostwood, the Twin Peaks podcast. Yeah. So it made perfect sense to talk about on Drunk Cinema, right?
Yeah, it sure did.
Yeah. So this was obviously from June 11th, 1986. 5 days before my 17th birthday.
Right.
Back in the day.
Did you see it in the theater?
I did not. I did not get a chance to see this in the theater because I was just, you know, becoming a senior and I didn't have a lot of money, so we didn't get to go out and see it. So, yeah. So I had to wait for it to a home video.
So I was 10, so my mom took me and my friend Carrie Gilliam to go see.
No relation to Terry Gilliam, I'm guessing.
No relation to Terry Gilliam, no.
Yeah.
But I hadn't seen her in years. She's out there somewhere. How's it going, Carrie?
How's it going?
Good egg. She's a good egg. Yeah. So, Charles, how are you watching Ferris Bueller tonight?
Well, tonight I am watching via the iPads.
Nice. All right. Well, I
have a digital copy that I'm using, but you, I understand, are breaking out the DVD.
My DVD is awesome. You want to see why?
Why?
Signed by Alan Ruck.
Oh, I can't. Yeah, there it is. I couldn't see it because of the glare. There was glare from the plastic.
Take it out of the thingy. Yeah, but it is signed.
Sweet.
God, it's so glare. And it says, to Xan, swing better.
Nice.
Candidate, swing better.
Where did you meet him?
Toronto.
Okay.
Met him in Toronto.
Yeah.
And then we went at a big group dinner and he and I talked about Pez for a while. He's like, so I just read that some Pez went on auction for like $30,000. So I told him all about that. And so we talked about Pez and
nice.
Had a nice time.
Did you tell him about the Pez room? Or didn't you not have the Pez room at the
I did
time?
Not have a Pez room at the time.
Oh. Yeah. This is pre-Pez room.
Pre-Pez room, yeah.
Excellent. So I also have my own Ferris Bueller memorabilia. Nothing as cool as what you've got.
Sweet! That is one of the greatest acquisitions in the history of acquisitions. It was one of the most wanted soundtrack of the 80s that did not exist.
Yeah, if I recall correctly, yeah, because I have the soundtrack I'm holding in my hot little hands on the physical media. Yeah. And if I recall correctly, I was the one that told you that it existed.
Well, because I stopped looking. It's like you stop looking for dragons eventually when you grow up because they don't exist. Yeah. But that thing was the unicorn of soundtracks for a while. So I'm glad somebody finally put one out.
Yeah, they did it in like a limited edition of 5,000 units. And from La La Land Records, if you can track it down.
La La Land is so fucking great. Yeah. Oh my gosh, guys. They have a great website and they have things broken down by like, hey, this stuff's almost ready to be sold out. So if you're feeling on the fence, they definitely put the pressure on you.
Yeah, I'm definitely on their mailing list. And I also decided to wear this for the occasion.
Oh, nice. I used to have, and I don't know what happened to this t-shirt.
My Save Ferris t-shirt, by the way.
Save Ferris. I had one that was Abe Froman, Sausage King of Chicago.
Oh, that's even better.
Yeah, it was, where were we? Kansas City when I bought that. And we were sitting next to my friend Kat Staggs. We were sitting by her table and she's like, what'd you buy? And I'm like, this t-shirt. It was like when I first met her. She's like, that's awesome. I'm like, okay, good. They shouldn't think I'm a complete total weirdo. So it was pretty funny.
So tonight we are drinking, since I was the designated podcaster.
Yeah, that's right. The responsible one.
Yeah, well, so to speak.
But relatively. Yeah,
relatively responsible.
What does that tell you about me?
If you talk to my wife, Lori probably would dispute that.
Well,
assessment.
Lori's the most responsible one because she's not here.
Yeah, she's not even drinking with us. So.
The responsible ones are Lori and Chris. Between the two of us, and the responsible one is you.
Yeah, we're kind of like not really good influences on one another tonight.
No, we're not. Yeah.
Yeah. But I'm going to be drinking a Blue Moon. You saw me standing So,
hey, you know, we should do American Werewolf in London.
That would be a good one, too. Yeah, I haven't watched that in a while.
Yeah, that's a good movie.
That's a great movie. Great movie. John Landis. Yeah. Can't go wrong with that.
I am drinking.
Yeah, what are you drinking, Xan?
I'm drinking Warrior Whiskey from, where is this from? Steamboat Springs, Colorado.
Salute.
And what this is it's a blend of American-made bourbon and rye, and it's finished in newly emptied rum casks. So it's like bourbon and rye in rum barrels. So you really couldn't ask for a whole heck of a lot more. But Warrior Whiskey, some of their profits go to U.S. veteran support organizations.
Yeah.
Oh, and this bottle was bought for me by my friend Lucy, who is married to my friend Juice, and Lucy is a veteran. So,
excellent.
Happily supporting veteran support.
There you go. It's
a terrible thing when a country sends somebody to serve their country, but then says, you know what? Fuck yourself. You're on your own with medical bills.
Yeah, so, exactly. So
that's
if our government isn't going to do the right thing, then you should do the right thing by buying this whiskey and supporting our veterans.
You can buy whiskey and help fix it a little bit.
There you go. It's a win-win for everyone, right? And by the way, apparently Xan just tried this for the very first time, and she approves, definitely.
Literally, Juice just dropped it off at like 7:30 tonight. So.
Nice. It must be nice to have friends that just drop off booze at odd hours.
Well, they recently went to Colorado, and they came back with some booze for me because I went and got their mail and checked on their house and made sure it wasn't leaking after a rain and stuff. So,
oh, cool.
They're like, let's buy her some booze. I'm like, all right. I'll watch your house whenever if that's going to be the deal. So.
Yeah, I'm sure that required a lot of arm twisting. Ow, ow, ow. Yeah.
It did. Yeah. Yeah, it really, really did.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So Ferris Bueller's Day Off, obviously a teen comedy from 1986, written and directed by the great John Hughes.
The late, great John Hughes.
Yeah.
Cheers, John Hughes.
Cheers to John Hughes. Yes. Tink. And obviously he directed 16 Candles, Weird Science, The Breakfast Club, Planes, Trains, Automobiles, and more.
And the holiday classic, Home Alone.
There you go. Not a bad resume, needless to say.
He also wrote some great movies, such as Some Kind of Wonderful and Mr. Mom.
Yeah, starring, of course, Michael Keaton, who we talked about last time.
Yeah, which I like to think started the trend of John Hughes characters talking into the mirror.
Okay, interesting. Yeah, like Macaulay Culkin in Home Alone.
Ferris, when he's talking to the camera, he's in the bathroom, so he's kind of like he's talking to the
mirror. Oh, yeah. Okay, that makes sense.
Macaulay Culkin's one is great. He's like, I watched all my major crevices, including in both of my ears and in my belly button. It's sort of enjoyed.
Yeah. And obviously this movie is a perfect example of John Hughes' great ear for dialogue. Mm-hmm. He's got a great comedic sense, great comedic timing, and yeah, I just love the script to bits.
And everybody in this movie is so perfect. Matthew Broderick is perfect.
As Ferris. Yeah.
Alan Ruck became one of my all-time favorite actors because of this movie. Alan Ruck is why I went to go see the movie Twister.
Yeah, he's in that. I was going to write it. Yeah. Also, Captain John Harriman in Star Trek Generations, the captain of the Enterprise B.
Heck yeah, he was. Which is how I was able to meet him at a convention, because that's why he does conventions.
For the Star Trek thing, yeah.
Also, he is from Ohio. He is from the Parma area.
Okay, that was my neck of the woods, basically, growing up, just outside of Medina.
And, you know, when all the other girls had the crush on Ferris, I had a crush on Cameron because I apparently like a mess.
Yeah.
So I like a neurotic mess. And I think Cameron is what did it to me, was my preference for neurotic mess boys over the confident boys.
Well, I resemble that remark, neurotic mess. So just a little bit. But
next time you're sick, I'm going to call you and make you come over.
She'll keep calling me. Make me come over. By the way, that reminds me. So for those who don't know, Xan loves the scene of Cameron debating in his car about whether to go over to Ferris.
Every car I've ever purchased.
Yes.
I do that routine.
Yeah. And she actually recreated it for me not too long ago over the Skype.
The first car I ever bought was a 1988 Dodge Omni, and this was in 1994. And my parents bought me a car. It was like a $1,500 car. They just paid for it out of the checkbook, right? So my first car, and I just drove to an empty parking lot, and I just sat there by myself and just went, he'll keep calling me until I come over. He made me feel guilty. And then this is ridiculous. Okay, I'll go. Shit. I would turn the car on and off, and I even bang the seat.
Yeah.
And I don't always bang the seat now in the nicer cars that I'm in, but I do turn it on and off and get out of the car and jump up and down.
In the background. So we could see you through the back windshield, the rear windshield.
Yep. So I do that. And also because I'm here in Columbus, Ohio, every new car gets a trip down Cook Road.
If we ever get to the magic point where we can actually see each other again, we need to recreate that, and I will sit on the hood of the car.
I know Christine wants video.
And I will film that,
Yeah. I know Christine wants
video. I think it would be fantastic.
So, yeah.
That'd be one hell of a YouTube video.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, we can certainly do that.
That would be fantastic.
But, this is, like I said, this is the first movie I ever memorized, which is a pretty amazing feat because I never owned this on VHS as a kid.
Yeah.
This was all purely from, checking this out in the library, 1,000 times.
Yeah.
So Alan Ruck aside, one person who I think steals this movie is Jennifer Grey.
Yes.
Jennifer Grey.
As
Jeannie Bueller, mostly for her role in Dirty Dancing, but which is great, that's great, but she's a really fantastic comedic actress and this movie is proof of that. So a little shout out to Jennifer Grey. Mia Sara. Mm-hmm. Didn't do much, but this movie and Time Cop are enough for me because I love Time Cop. It's a time travel movie. I love it. It's great.
So in addition to Sloane Peterson, she was in Legend.
Legend, yes, which I've never seen, of course.
Yeah. And I developed a major crush on her because, she played Harley Quinn on the WB version of Birds of Prey back in 2002.
Yep, that's right.
Which I was amazed. Now, originally that role was going to go to Sherilyn Fenn from Twin Peaks.
Sherilyn Fenn. Yeah, there was a pilot filmed with Sherilyn.
Yeah, there's an alternate version of the pilot, exactly, that exists with Sherilyn Fenn as Harley Quinn.
I think I have that somewhere still.
Yeah. when they got the pickup, they decided to go with Mia Sara instead.
If you're gonna diss Sherilyn Fenn, Mia Sara is your only possible.
That's a good replacement, right?
Yeah.
And she did a great job with the role. I mean, she was the first live action Harley.
She's really good. yeah, she's great. I got nothing against Mia Sara. She's, you know, she hasn't done a whole heck of a lot of stuff. So
some other notable people in this movie, Jeffrey Jones, obviously, is Edward R. Rooney.
He makes me so uncomfortable now.
Yeah, it's kind of hard to talk about. I mean, even though he's like in all these great Tim Burton movies.
He's in all these great Tim Burton movies. He's
in Deadwood.
He's in Deadwood.
Yeah.
He's in Stay Tuned, which I recently did during my bad movie month in September.
Yeah. The one with John Ritter and Pam Dauber, right?
Yeah, fantastic movie. Very underrated movie. Directed by Peter Hyams, who directed 2010.
There you go. Good resume there.
The problem I think with people who get branded as actors for TV is they think they get overlooked a lot of the time on what their talents really are.
Yeah.
But John Ritter's fantastic. He goes from style to style to style to style in that movie, and he does a great job. And I just, is it really that hard to look at naked people that are over 18? Like, is it really that hard to, like, have sex with?
It shouldn't be.
With 18 and over people, is it that hard?
It shouldn't be. And also, even if you are registered as a sex offender, that isn't that hard to re-register as a sex offender like you're supposed to?
It's not that hard, okay?
Yeah.
It's like, maybe just avoid another felony, please, mm-hmm. Jeffrey Jones.
Right.
Because it's like, there are people out there. Now, I will say that I feel like we throw the sex offender thing around a little too much.
Mm-hmm.
Like, drunk people who pass out peeing in a park.
Yeah.
I don't think they're sex offenders. I think they're drunks.
They're just, yeah.
Right. This is, personally, though, I feel like this is why boys get in trouble, because they don't pee where they're supposed to, you know?
Mm-hmm. Pee
in a fucking bathroom, you guys, and you would not get this. But that's the thing. It's like, if you passed out while you were drinking, that's fine. If you're a flasher, go fuck yourself. That is sex offense, because that's like a violent thing that you're doing. Like, it's a... Yep. I mean, it's not violent, but you know what I'm saying.
I know what you're saying. Yeah.
It's just,
you're a nonviolent offender. Yeah.
You are a nonviolent. What is that? Aaron's List? Did you ever see that?
No. What?
It's a Saturday Night Live
sketch about.
Where they're talking about, like, Angie's List and how it's, you know, how everything is expensive.
Yeah.
So there's Aaron's List, which is the something registry of nonviolent sex offenders. And it's people like that passed out peeing or something. And like Pete Davidson is like, I exposed myself to the Jumbotron. Take that, Kiss Cam. Like, I'm living under a bridge and I'm ready to work. It's just people who like thought they sent dick pics to their ex-girlfriend, but they sent them to their ex-girlfriend's niece instead or something. Like,
okay.
It's stuff like that. We got Aaron's List for the Registry of Nonviolent Sex Offenders to come do your.
That's funny.
Do your stuff. But no, I'm sorry. If you start messing around with people under the age of 18 or looking at photos of people under the age of 18 that really shouldn't have been photographed in the first place, that's a problem. And not only did you commit a felony and screw up your own life, now you've ruined Christmas. Thank you very much, Kevin Spacey.
Yeah.
You know? So.
Yeah, Kevin Spacey's a whole nother rant, I would say.
Kevin Spacey's like legit a rapist, but still. I mean, what did he say he was? Like
13, alleged rapist, at least. Yeah. Yeah.
No, I believe just about anything.
Well, we have to kind of say that legally, probably. That, yeah.
Well, we have to say that legally, but, you know, I was watching this movie the other day.
Yeah.
A movie directed by the great Chris Columbus, Adventures in Babysitting.
Mm-hmm. Harry Potter, first two films. Yeah.
Yeah. Which is where in
Goonies.
Goonies. Which is where, writer of Goonies. Which is where 1987 Adventures in Babysitting is where I first developed my crush on Anthony Rapp.
Okay. But way before Star Trek Discovery.
Way before Star Trek Discovery. Way before Rent. It's like I was excited to see Rent because Anthony Rapp was in it.
Okay.
So, major love for the Anthony Rapp. So, you know, I don't believe that he would make shit like that up. So, yeah. So now Kevin Spacey's ruined Christmas because I have to feel uncomfortable when I watch The Ref now. Thanks a lot for that.
Yeah. And House of Cards just completely has been ruined. Ruined.
House of Cards is now unemployed. Thanks a lot for that, Kevin Spacey.
Yeah, way to go.
He's just like some gaffer on House of Cards, waking up in the morning, reading that shit and going, okay, I guess I'm fired.
Yeah.
I don't have a freaking job anymore.
Pretty much. So on a brighter note, thankfully, we have the great Edie McClurg as Grace, his secretary.
An underrated comedic actress. She, Edie McClurg, was a member of the Groundlings in Los Angeles. The Groundlings, which of course gave us people like Pee Wee Herman, Phil Hartman, Lynn Stewart, Kristen Wiig, Melissa McCarthy.
Yeah, I was just going to say that, Melissa McCarthy.
So, Edie McClurg was in The Groundlings, and she was in Carrie. I mean, she's been all over the place.
Yeah, she was in Carrie. She's been Back to School with Rodney Dangerfield. One of my personal favorites, A Bug's Life. She is hilarious in Bug's Life.
Mm-hmm.
Natural Born Killers, of all things.
Yeah, isn't she the mom in Natural Born Killers?
Yeah, I think so. Yeah, the Rodney Dangerfield's wife or something?
Rodney Dangerfield's wife, yeah.
Yeah, so pretty interesting actress. Pretty fun. Obviously a great distinctive voice.
Oh, yeah.
And then she just steals every scene she's in as Grace, as far as I'm concerned.
Oh, she's...
Yeah, she turns a nothing role into something beautiful and amazing.
I think she's a righteous dude.
Yeah, I think she's a righteous dude, exactly. I think that was an ad lib, by the way, when she said that. We had Lyman Ward as Tom Bueller. Cindy Pickett as Katie Bueller.
Yeah.
Ben Stein as the economics teacher.
Anyone?
Bueller. And nice little debut by Charlie Sheen, some guy you may have heard of. As the, quote unquote, the boy in the police station, as in, do you do drugs?
Shauna. Ooh, Shauna Jean.
Yeah.
Jeannie. Yeah. I love that song.
If you say Ferris Bueller, you lose a testicle.
You lose a testicle. Oh, you know him.
Yeah.
You gotta spend a little more time worrying about yourself, a little less time worrying about what your brother does.
Yeah, yeah. So very sage advice from the drugged out Charlie Sheen on this one.
Blow yourself.
Yeah. It's a good prognosticator of art imitating life in a lot of ways with Charlie Sheen.
Yeah, why don't you get your thumb up your butt? I don't know why I'm here. Why are you here? Yeah. Drugs.
Drugs, yeah.
A little too prophetic, this movie, but still.
So this movie, 1 hour, 43 minute runtime.
Mm-hmm.
No Academy Awards, but Matthew Broderick was nominated for a Golden Globe in 1987.
Right.
For Best Actor in a Motion Picture, Musical, or Comedy.
During the Academy Awards, the year that John Hughes passed away,
mm-hmm.
Matthew Broderick did a shout out to him saying, John Hughes is the reason why whenever people see him on the street to this day, they still say, hey, Ferris, is it your day off?
And he's probably like, fuck you, John Hughes. No.
He still gets that. No, I think he owns it. I mean, how great would it be to be Ferris Bueller? That's like that's like being James Bond, but for Gen X comedy fans.
This is true, yeah. I'm sure it's a certain age bracket, but yeah.
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 This is a quintessential Gen X movie, if you ask me.
Yeah. Otherwise, it's probably the younger generation that knows him from being Simba in Lion King, probably.
Yeah, he's Ferris Bueller in Simba. I don't know what else he wants out of life.
War Games, Lady Hawk, that horrible Godzilla movie from 1998.
That doesn't exist. We don't talk about that.
Okay. We're not going to talk about that.
We don't talk. We don't.
We're going to leave Godzilla out.
We're going to leave Godzilla out of it.
I knew where you were going with that.
Yeah.
All right. Score by
Ira. Do you know who that is there?
Score by Ira Newborn, who did, just like John Hughes, obviously a big John Hughes staple. So 16 Candles, Weird Science, Planes, Trains, and Automobiles, and also Mallrats, among others. So I thought that was pretty neat.
I believe
neat.
They got him for Mallrats because of his John Hughes connection.
Makes sense, because I know that Kevin Smith is a huge John Hughes geek, as I understand.
Well, and in Mallrats, they have, is it Mallrats or is it Chasing Amy, where they talk about how they went to Shermer, Illinois to deal drugs because they figured out they didn't really have a lot of drug dealers there by watching the John Hughes movies, and then they found out that there is no such place as Shermer, Illinois.
I think that's Chasing Amy.
Which movie is that? Was that Chasing Amy? Okay.
I think it's Chasing Amy. I could be wrong, but I think it's Chasing Amy.
It's been a while, so I don't remember.
Yeah, I know.
There
I
is
know.
No Shermer, Illinois. I thought it was hilarious.
So I can have some trivia, but we could probably save that for when we watch the movie.
We could save that for when we watch the movie. Charles, I have as once again, our disclaimer, Charles and I are at home.
Yes.
Not driving, not anywhere outside of home, near a bathroom. Our spouses are nearby and they are aware that we're doing this.
Yes.
So we're being safe and
being responsible.
Yeah.
So.
I have.
Please podcast responsibly.
So, and I have munchies, so we're not drinking on empty stomachs.
Yeah.
And
like last time.
Like last time.
Yeah.
What I have tonight is popcorn, pretzels, and jelly beans because it's Thanksgiving weekend.
Yep.
And we are having a Charlie Brown Thanksgiving here.
That sounds like a very Charlie Brown Thanksgiving, yes.
Popcorn, pretzels, jelly beans, and toast is what they ate for dinner in this Charlie Brown Thanksgiving.
But to be fair, you should be eating off of a ping pong table.
I should be eating off a ping pong table, and because it's Ferris Bueller's Day Off, they probably should be gummy bears instead of jelly beans.
Yeah, that was one thing I was lamenting because I was so determined to remember to bring those and have them in my pocket, so they're really real nice and soft.
So they're warm and soft. Yeah. No, I just went for the festive jelly bean rather than the movie relation. So, but Rooney eats it.
Nice. Oh yeah. All right. So if everybody's ready, why don't we queue up our movies and have our wonderful listeners synchronize at home?
Have our wonderful So what we're doing is we have the movie set to right when the Paramount logo goes. This is one thing I have, Charles.
Ooh, the yellow one. I can't see the second. One second. Yeah.
Which has the song "Oh Yeah," because back in the day, Charles, this is the only way you could get that song because there was no Ferris Bueller's Day Off soundtrack.
Well, yes, because I was just going to say it is on the Ferris Bueller soundtrack. So if you want it,
it is. So I
also
got that,
right. It also has, by the way, it also has "Love Missile," F-111, the Ultra Violence mix
Sputnik.
By Sig Sputnik, and "Beat City" by the Flower Pot Men. They did really well.
Flower Pot Men, probably "Zap" by Radio People by Zap.
Yep.
"Taking the Day Off" by General Public. "March of the Swivel Heads" by the English Beat.
General Public is not on there.
Really? "Taking the Day Off" by General Public is not on there.
Nope, not on this one. They didn't get the full soundtrack. They were only allowed certain songs.
Well.
So you have BAD by Big Audio Dynamite. You have "Please, Please, Please Let Me Get What I Want"
by
Dream Academy.
Dream Academy, not by the Smiths.
Yep. "Donkey and Shane," of course, by Wayne Newton.
"Edge of Forever" by Dream Academy.
Yep.
See, I'm telling you, I had to make my own bootleg soundtrack back in the day.
And also, "I'm Afraid" by Blue Room.
I am afraid of so many things.
Yeah.
Yeah.
There are a lot of great music cues on this as well by Ira Newborn.
Ira Newborn did a fantastic job in this one. And he did a great job decorating Ferris's bedroom. He has a Simple Minds poster that I would kill somebody for.
Yeah.
So.
And also, it has this great piece of music.
Chiqui, bonjour.
Yep. Snooty, snooty, snotty.
Naughty.
Snotty.
I weep for the future.
Yeah. It's one of my favorite lines. I still use it to this day.
I weep for the future. Look at how, blotchy I'm already getting. All red and drunk and blotchy already. So should we start the fucking movie?
Yeah. Well, see, that's one of the benefits of being on a podcast. People wouldn't notice that unless you tell them.
You already started this trend of telling all of our secrets, Charles.
You yelled at me for doing that. You're like, why are you telling everything?
You needed to get me drunk and then I wouldn't care.
Oh, is that the secret?
That's how this works.
Okay. Well, then I'm on board with this now. All right. So for everybody playing the home game, and we definitely hope we want you to participate right along with us. Cue, like Xan said, cue your video up. Black screen of blackness right after the Paramount logo, which is like about 13 seconds in.
Okay. That works for me.
All right. So
why are my closed captions not working?
Because you haven't turned them on?
Well, that's what I'm trying to do. Options. Let's go to top menu again. Let's try this again. All right.
Okay.
Setup. Doubly English surround sound. Okay.
Right.
It works. English for the deaf. All right. So doubly English surround. There we go. English for the hard of hearing. Now we're ready to go.
Okay. Are we cool? All right. So remember, as we watch this, only the meek get pinched. The bold survive.
Bold survive.
Yes. So if everybody's ready, we will do this in 3, 2, 1. Doink.
W.L.S. It's beautiful Chicago day. How can I possibly be expected to handle school on a day
like this? Yes. Yeah. Now I'm going to enjoy my orange slice.
I think you should. Your orange slice out of your beer. I've already got my ice is already melted, so I'm probably going to. Tom?
It's one of the things I like about a Blue Moon. It has a nice citrus flavor.
Yes. Well, for Christ's sakes, look at him, honey. Oh, I love Ferris pretending to be sick.
Rule number one to faking out the parents.
Sputs. When you're bent over, moaning and wailing,
it's a matter of parents.
Papa?
Now, is it just me, or does Ferris's mom kind of look a little bit like Jamie Summers on Bionic Woman? Lindsay Wagner, a little bit.
She has a little bit of that Lindsay Wagner thing.
Okay, so it's not just me.
Yeah. So I'm starting to realize that I think maybe subconsciously, what's his problem? Look at Jeannie's awesome 80s outfit.
Right.
With her, like, belt that's not necessary because it's obviously elastic pants. Jeannie? Is that you?
Jeannie?
I can't see that far. I don't quite understand Ferris and Jeannie's relationship. I don't know. Is she like a sophomore or a junior?
I think she's a year older than her, yeah. Older than Ferris, yes.
Yeah.
Well, she's probably the older sister.
No, she's younger because he's the senior.
Oh, that's right. They're graduating and going to college. You're absolutely right.
I have to graduate in June. I want to go to a good college so I can have a fruitful life. So, I want out of this family. So we have great siblings. So I'm realizing that probably subconsciously, Ferris Bueller's room has dictated my musical taste since I was very young. Because the poster behind his bed is Brian Ferry, Slave to Love. And then he has a poster over by his door that's Simple Minds, which, Charles, you know, but I don't know if all of our listeners out in podcast land know this, but Jim Kerr is number one on my gimme list.
So, oh, is he?
You know, Chris just has to deal.
That's the exception.
If Jim Kerr ever shows up. Yeah.
Okay. All right.
He is the number one. He is number one on my exception to my marriage list. So
there you go. Okay, pumpkin.
Pumpkin, pumpkin. Ringy dingy.
Ringy dingy.
Yes, he's got a gigantic Brian Ferry Slave to Love poster. I love that song, and I love Brian Ferry. And me.
I used to dream of having a room this cool when I was in high school.
I know. I mean, this is.
I want to know. I would settle for at least the Union Jack flag.
They bought it.
This is pure Gen X right here. The MTV.
The worst performances of my career, and they never doubted it for a second. I love even these curtains, like he's like parachute curtains. And how does he get that corner room like that?
That's right. Supposed to be expected to handle school on a day like this.
It's a gorgeous day. It's like 74 degrees out. But yeah, this is 1986.
So let's rock to the Seek Sputnik.
Yeah, with all of its Nazi bullshit in the background.
Yep. Well, we don't talk about that.
Yeah. Key to faking out the parents is the clammy hands. It's a big symptom. I'm a big believer in it. A lot of people will tell you that a phony fever is a good lock, but you get a nervous mother, you could wind up in a doctor's office. That's worse than school. And I love how he's obviously done this before. Like, he knows exactly what to do with his trophies. And
he's very calm and methodical.
Yeah. I mean, look at that room. He's got that hollow body guitar. He's got that stereo system that's probably $2,000.
That's cool. Exactly.
You don't stop.
Life moves pretty fast.
You could miss it.
If you don't stop and look around once in a while, you can miss it. That mantra actually helped me get through high school. Seriously, that was the thing that got me out of my house and going out and actually living life for a change.
They could be fascist anarchists and still wouldn't change the fact that I don't own a car.
Now you got to respect the shower mohawk.
I love the shower mohawk.
Dunk a shame, Central Park and fall. How you tore your dress, what a mess.
And here we have to wash his genitals, so you're not supposed to...
I love how he, like, holds his hand up to the camera. Yeah. It's the clone fascism, or anyism for that measure. Isms, in my opinion, are not good. Fish should not believe in an ism. He should believe in himself. I quote Dylan, I don't believe in Beatles. I just believe in me.
I could be the walrus. I'd still have to bum rides off of people. Here. Oh, yes. Christy Swanson, everybody.
Yep. Christy Swanson before Buffy, presumably.
Who also makes a cameo appearance as the Ducky girl in Pretty in Pink. This is one of the first things I rewound and rewatched to memorize is her explaining how he's sick. He's sick. see, my best friend's boyfriend's brother's, my best friend's sister's boyfriend's brother's girlfriend heard from this guy who knows this kid who's going with a girl that saw Ferris pass out at 31 Flavors last night. I guess it's pretty serious. So, yeah, that was the first thing I memorized, and then the rest of the movie just sort of fell into place.
Hello.
Like, where is this fucking house?
Right.
Like, this needs to be on some sort of tour somewhere. Oh, Vic's Vapo Rub. And
Yeah.
These are, let me tell you something, you guys, about what it must have lived, what it was like to live in the 80s, okay? Do you want to know how we know these were rich kids? Because they had amazing phones.
Yeah.
All right? Not just like the fact that they live in these houses, not just the fact that Cameron has his own car, not anything like that. Just they have like good phones in their bedroom. That was nothing that we had any access to in the 80s as kids. I feel like complete shit, Ferris. I can't go anywhere.
Come on over here and pick me up.
I'm tired of this stuff. Oh. Yeah, he's got an automatic answering machine in his own room, so he obviously has his own line. I'm dying.
Ferris probably bought him that for, you know, future school.
No, his parents are wealthy. Yeah. You're not dying. You just can't think of anything good to do.
So his day off, it's Cameron.
See?
I love the Hawaiian music.
He's got a lot of things to sort out as he graduates. Can't go to college and be this wound up. His roommate will kill him.
Egypt's land.
When Cameron was in Egypt's land.
Let my Cameron go.
Cameron
is so tight. If you stuck a lump of coal up his ass, so tight. You
in 2 weeks you have a diamond. See, Ferris and Cameron have been friends since they were children, so Ferris knows him really well. Katie Bueller. Oh my god. This is the thing. When you were sick, your parents had to call the school,
right,
and let them know that you were sick so they wouldn't think that you were just missing or something like that. Well, I would sometimes be sick for like a couple of days in a row, like I'd have the flu or I'd have strep throat or something like that. And my mom, the second day I would be out, I would get a phone call from my school secretary and I'd answer the phone and be like, hello.
I gotta mention and this. It would be, Edie McClurg. So Grace is pulling pencils out of her hair.
Like, there's like four pencils in there. And Mr. Rooney's office has like flies and bullshit in it and stuff. Mouth. But
he's sorely mistaken.
Sorely mistaken. In fact, I have no reservations whatsoever about holding him back another year. The
creepy Jeffrey Jones smile, by the way.
Creepy Jeffrey Jones, yeah.
Nine times.
And here we have a little throwback to Ferris's days from War Games, where he can hack into the school.
That's probably where he picked that up. It's like, yeah, he did War Games, so. Because otherwise, you know, how would he hack a school computer in the 80s?
I've got it right here in front of me. He has been, he's missed 9 days.
Shall we play a game?
Doot.
Car, I got a computer. How's that for being born under a bad sign?
Yeah. Grace.
Grace!
I love her with the
white out. She's sniffing glue. Sniffing the white out, yeah.
Grace!
I bet she's a Ramones fan.
I know, right? I want to sniff some glue.
Yep. Now I want to sniff some glue.
Grace! I can appreciate how this time of year children are prone to taking the day off, but I can assure you, in Ferris's case, he is really a very sick boy.
This apparently was just Matthew Broderick screwing around and they filmed it.
Yeah, look at that. Killing Joke, Flesh for Lulu. Ferris, there's another Brian Ferry poster.
Yep. He's way hip.
Oh my god, I love all that music. I love all those bands.
I would dream of being that cool back then.
Ferris Bueller really, really shaped my psyche back in 1986.
Yeah.
Anyone?
So Ben Stein was actually, he actually has a degree in economics and was asked by John Hughes to present an economics lecture. So nothing on this scene is scripted, apparently.
No, nothing. This is fantastic.
This is totally
Did it work? Anyone know the effects?
Anyone?
It did not work in the United States.
They burned the Great Depression. I love this squint right here.
I know, right here. She's like,
I'm going to kill you. Yeah.
I love this guy. He's my favorite.
He's just drooling. He's just zoned.
Staring. Nothing.
The drool.
On the revenue curve. Oh, the drool is fantastic. Where he's asleep and he's drooling. Oh, this is very. Does anybody know what Vice President Bush called this in 1980? Anyone?
Something. DOO economics. Voodoo economics.
Voodoo economics.
I dream a genie.
Yeah, Ferris is just dancing around. See, that's the thing. Like, if I took the day off of school, this is what I would do. I would just dance around my room and probably watch this movie. Like, I wouldn't just go into the middle of Chicago or anything like that. It would be. No. I love these airplane earrings too.
See, I would go to the ball game. I would do the ball game and maybe the art gallery.
So
such
I
a sweetie. Gotta go.
I had both of their hair at some point in the '80s. I had Jeannie's perm in the sixth grade. Oh, these freshmen.
Did you see Alien?
When that creature, look at that.
Oh, no, not again. This is what Xan was doing at the end of last episode, you guys, in drug cinema, in case you're wondering. He's getting me out of summer school.
Yeah, he's getting me out of summer school.
Yeah, that's a ticket.
Yeah. Hey, give me somebody else.
Can't handle summer school.
Hope he doesn't die. Can't handle summer school. I will say this, Charles. There's no swearing on these captions.
Oh, there isn't?
No, there's not. So I am...
Well, on mine there is.
Weird, yeah.
Yeah.
I guess the deaf or hearing impaired, they have sensitive ears. Oh my God, you're dying? Uh-oh. I think I might need a kidney transplant. You could be alive this weekend?
It's you.
I love all of these clothes.
Yeah, I'd say I'll be alive this weekend.
Yeah. Do you notice that I'm wearing a... This is the Blue Danube, everybody.
Yep.
Well,
you're bad back. Oh, bad knee. I thought it was a bad back.
The bad knee. Yeah, it's bad knee. Suck your head. It's true.
Yep.
That is why I have to catch him this time.
Grace's perkiness against Rooney's, curmudgeonliness is perfect right here in this scene.
Jeopardizes my ability to effectively govern this student body. Well, he makes you look like an ass is what he does, Ed.
I think you're wrong. He's very popular, Ed.
Oh, but he's very popular, Ed.
The Sportos, the Motorheads, Geeks, Sluts.
Motorheads.
Bloods, Wastoids, Dweebies, Dickheads. They all adore him. They think he's a righteous dude.
He's a righteous dude. Because she's so freaking adorable. He's being so serious. He is so creepy to look at now.
I know. It's a little unsettling, isn't it? It's probably going to be even creepier when he goes into the arcade. Later
on. Yeah. I'm like Dirty Harry just then. Really? Thanks, Grace.
Squints. Yeah.
Yeah. He's doing his Eastwood impression.
Oh.
This is ridiculous making me wait around the house for you.
Old school mouse, everybody.
Oh, yeah. If I go for 10, I won't graduate. Draw me like one of your French girls, Ferris. Take some Best of Bismol and come on over here.
I'm tired of this stuff.
Hold your water for a second. Hello.
Oh.
Hi.
Hi.
Really? Darn, I thought I was improving. Dad, can you hang on a second? Okay, for all of you young people out there, this is what's called call waiting.
Yeah.
And here's the thing about it, is that what you would do is you would press down. If you don't come over here in 15 minutes, you can find a new best friend. You would stay on that system.
Yeah.
Anyway, if you press down on your
receiver, yeah,
it would switch to another call, but it wouldn't always switch to the other call, which like where he just goes, Cameron, it's my dad.
Sometimes he's hang up.
Yeah, he's taking his life in his hands because it could have still been his dad, frankly.
Right. Sometimes it didn't always switch over like he thought it would.
Yeah. Wrap a hot towel around my head. I love you too.
So disappointed in Cameron.
I'm so disappointed in Cameron. $20 says he's sitting in his car debating.
I'm just going to stand out of the way for this.
He'll keep calling me. He'll keep calling me until I come over. He'll make me feel guilty. This is ridiculous. Okay, I'll go. I'll go. Shit. Oh, Cameron's house is so amazing. I'm not going.
So Cameron, perfection. Go back. Cut. Print it.
Yeah. He comes, but then.
And then they get the little postscript. Yeah, he's.
I'm so mad at himself.
So that's what I mean. I got to be in, like, on the hood of the car. This is Del Close, by the way. He was in the Blob. The 1988 Blob.
Way. The author's use of the prison.
You can't even do the prison bars right.
So let's take a minute here.
So like every class is boring at this high school.
Yeah, every class is boring at this high school.
Yeah.
The protagonists struggle. How does this relate to our discussion, the uses of irony? Let's take a moment.
It's like, thank God the nurse is here.
Yeah. And I love how she knows it's her. You know?
Sloane Peterson with a fringe jacket.
Oh, that leather jacket is amazing. Yeah. It's like she knows enough to like get her shit together and right. Like leave the classroom.
Yes.
Yeah. So let's take a minute, Charles, now that we're talking about Cameron.
Yeah.
To talk about the late great one, Mr. Hockey. Well, the great one is Wayne Gretzky.
Yes.
But let's talk about Mr. Hockey, Gordie Howe.
Gordie Howe. Who's that is the jacket from the Flyers that Cameron wears.
No,
the Detroit Red Wings. I'm sorry.
Jersey from the Red Wings.
The Detroit Red Wings, yes.
Yeah, sorry. The Red Wings. Thank you very much.
Yeah. Okay, I corrected it.
Yes.
I caught myself.
Oh, yeah. So... And I, like I said, I'm realizing as we watch this movie, how much this movie has influenced my life.
Why?
Well, I'll show you here in a second. Do you know who this my is, favorite hockey
this
team
is? George Peterson. Oh, there's Peterson. Mr. Hockey, Gordie Howe book, forward by Bobby Orr. Nice
Bobby
story.
Fucking Orr, man. Yeah. Yep. Okay, so I don't like a lot of professional sports, Charles, but I like tennis and I like hockey. And my favorite team is the Red Wings, and I'm pretty sure it's because of this movie.
Not the Blue Jackets. You're not showing the hometown loyalty.
Well, I liked the Red Wings before there were Blue Jackets.
I understand. A lot of fans are. They do that.
Yeah, I mean, if the Red Wings aren't playing, yeah, sure. The Blue
so
Jackets,
if you wouldn't mind excusing Sloane,
I'd appreciate it. Oh, you just produce a corpse, and I'll release Sloane. You know, that's school policy. I want to see this dead grandmother firsthand. See, here's another reason why we knew that these people were rich people, Charles.
Yes, yeah.
They had multiple lines, phone lines in their house.
Right.
That was not a thing that all of us had.
No, I didn't have that.
Ed, did you say you wanted to see a mother?
I lived in a pretty good neighborhood, and I didn't have that.
Yeah. All right. So I'm getting really drunk really fast.
Yeah.
So I'm going to have a pretzel. I'll be right back.
All right. Ed Rooney's office.
Thank you.
Oh.
Hold. Tell you what, dipshit.
Ed.
If you don't like my policies, you can come on down here and smooch my big old white butt. Fuck her up, Buttercup.
Ferris Bueller's online, too.
Nice! Awesome. Hey, Mr. Rooney, how you doing?
How you doing?
Sorry to disturb you at work, but I'm not feeling well today. And I was wondering if it might be possible for my sister to pick up any assignments from my classes that I might need.
He doesn't even do the fake voice, if you notice.
No, he doesn't. Have a nice day.
Bueller. Ferris Bueller.
Bong, bong.
I love the ominous, like,
the ominous, like, tone. The bell tolls.
Yeah. Well,
I should say you do. Sorry, for Christ's sake.
I think you should be sorry, for Christ's sake.
Family member dies and you insult me.
You insult me. What the hell is well with you anyway?
I love Cameron just like, yes.
Cameron's just dancing around. You didn't tell you how sorry I am. Pardon my French, but you're an asshole.
Pardon my French, but you're an asshole. Asshole.
Hit the nail right on the head, sir. I know where she is.
She heard me.
Line clear, Mr. Peterson.
Sir, goddammit.
Sir, goddammit.
That's better. It's a cue, busted it. You don't know who you're doing. Remember who you're dealing with. Bueller. Ferris Bueller. Bah, 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 bah.
No, I'm a little scared because what if he recognizes it?
Perfect.
Again,
I want to know where Cameron got his t-shirt.
No call. I love her. Jeffrey Jones.
Yes. Her Rooney impression. The scrambling is hilarious.
Short that makes and it short sweet. And sweet.
It's perfect.
I want my daughter to bring
this by herself. Smacks the phone.
You.
Come on.
Rooney. I'm changing my mind. I want popcorn now.
School with the free words with you, by God. But you kicked me.
Where's your brain?
Where's your brain? Where'd you kick me? Where's your brain?
I asked you first. Charles, I've decided that popcorn is the ultimate drunk food.
Does it work better than the pretzels?
You hit me. But don't ask me to participate in your stupid crap if you don't do it. You make me get out of bed. You make me come over here. You make me make a phony phone call
to Edward Rooney?
You make me squash my nuts into oblivion. And then you deliberately hurt my feelings. Oh, no? We're going. See you later, pal. I'm going home.
By the way, Alan Ruck was 27 when they made this movie.
I know, but he looks like a baby. He's so cute.
Yeah. Oh, Cameron, wait a minute.
I didn't mean to lose my temper. It was uncalled for. You did screw up, though. I love this.
Running and then pausing in front of the doors. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I ran through school like this all the time after I saw this movie. Because I was in the fourth grade when I saw this movie. Oh, Mug by Sandra Boynton. Everybody, Sandra Boynton.
Nicely spotted.
But to make up for
it. It's completely your fault.
I'm going to have to ask you for a small favor.
And no. Here we go.
And America was introduced to the German band Yellow. the 1961 Ferrari
250 GT California. Oh, yeah. It's a spider, by the way.
Less than 100 were made. I mean, it is his love. My father spent 3 years restoring this car. It is his love. It is his passion.
It is his fault that he didn't rot the garage. This isn't a real Ferrari, by the way.
No,
they couldn't. They couldn't afford a real Ferrari, so for the budget, so they built one like a shell and put it over another car.
A man with priorities so far out of whack should not have access to such a fine automobile.
They used like an MG chassis.
Nice. Apparently, you don't understand. Ferris, he never drives it. He just rubs it with a diaper. Hey, remember how my safety went when I broke my retainer? Huh? That was a little piece of plastic. This is a Ferrari.
Kibella.
You can't pick up phone in your car. Mr. Rudy would never believe that Mr. Peterson drives that piece of shit. It's not a piece of shit. It is a piece of shit. Don't worry about it. I don't even have a piece of shit of my own. I have to envy yours. I'm a little disappointed in something, Charles.
What?
My earbuds are dying.
Uh-oh.
And so what that means is that they're not holding a charge. It is so choice. Never has, never will. Look, this is real simple. Whatever miles you put on, we take off. We'll drive home backwards.
We'll drive home backwards.
No. Ferris, I'm putting my foot down. It is possible to stop Mr. Ferris Bueller, you know.
Yeah.
Nice stretch job with a TV and a bar. TV. Come on, live a little. Poor Cameron.
We're going riding with Biden.
I kind of like how at the end of this movie, they really do show you that Ferris does, in fact, really care about Cameron as a friend.
Well, he was willing to take the heat for it. So.
No, you don't want this much heat. No, I want it. If I didn't want it, I wouldn't let you take the car this morning. I made you take the car this morning.
Don't jump too far ahead now. We'll get there.
Eat some jelly beans. And never continueth in one day. Between grief and nothing, I'll take grief. Yeah, thanks for that.
Mm-hmm. Don't touch me.
Yeah, please don't touch me. I am not 18 yet!
This is where it started.
That is the... Actually, Charles, you know what? I think...
Yeah. This was him auditioning for in his Inspector Gadget movie.
Oh my god, I never thought about that. That's hilarious. I feel like... It's Gen X version of Giggity.
Yeah, it probably was. I think that's fair.
Yeah.
For your warmth and your compassion.
Where she's like a little bit flirty with him and kisses him and it's like...
Yeah.
Gross.
Yeah.
So,
well, she's got to sell it.
Yeah, she's got to sell it.
Shit.
Jeannie. I like how Jeannie spends her entire day. It's for daddy? Are you kidding me?
So that's...
I mean, wait till the...
So wait, here we have an incest joke. Great.
Mm-hmm. So that's how it is in their family. You know what? You're one to judge, Jeffrey.
You're right, pretty much.
Jesus. Hi, Cameron. You comfortable?
Hi, Sloane.
Hi, Sloane.
No. The question is, what aren't we going to do?
The question is, what are we going to do? Please don't say we're not going to take the car home. Please don't say we're not going to take the car home. Please don't say we're not going to take the car home.
Good access to a car like this.
Would you take it away right away?
Neither would I.
Beat City Downtown. Beep, 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 beep City Downtown.
Woo-hoo. I like this guitar riff right here. It's very Kids in the Hall. And the license plate says nervous, by the way.
Last time I checked, that is still taken in the state of Ohio.
Yeah. Oh, you tried?
I check every once in a while for nervous, and here's a geeky reference for you, Charles. Car 120C.
Yeah, that's from The Prisoner. Yeah. K-A-R 120C.
K-A-R 120C.
Yep. See, I would know that reference. I understood that reference.
I understood that reference. So, look, it's the Yankee Hotel Foxtrot. Mm-hmm. My friend Dave and I are
Chicago
in
before the fall. No.
My friend Dave and I are in a battle to see who can get car 120C first. But somebody hasn't taken it, and the fact that we aren't friends with them is really weird to me. I think I should know that person.
Yeah.
Run, 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 Beat City. Beat, 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 Beat City.
See, one of the best things about this movie that I love so much is that they don't just, like, go off to, like, do drugs or whatever. They just decide to go off and have a good time. Like, enjoy the day. Going downtown, enjoying...
They go to ball games.
They go to ball games. They go to the gallery. Say Ferris Bueller. Say Ferris.
It's money by Ferris New Kidney. And they cost 20 G's or so. So if you could help out, go piss on a flagpole. You old, should be.
Old school Pepsi can. Hey.
Hey, what if you need a favor someday from Ferris Bueller?
Bueller.
Then where will you be? You
heartless wench? Watch your mouth this time. Yeah.
Suck your head. We can't come to the phone right now. This is obviously like Sloane's room because there's nail polish and a charm necklace.
Yeah.
Her grandmother, too. Pinhead. We'll be on the phone.
Follow your number. And I love it. You can't even understand the number. It's just all like, but Grace somehow knows the number.
Well, I just don't think they give it to you. So
I understand. I understand. But it's just kind of funny, though. That.
Yeah. Ooh, cheese. I should eat. We have reached the Coffin Brothers mortuary.
Grill me
we
are cheese. Sorry
we're able to come to the phone right now, but if you leave your name and number, we'll get back to you
as soon as humanly possible.
Something's going on here, god damn it. I'm going to find out what it is. I'm just kidding. If I do, I'm going to put one hell of a dent in his future. 15 years from now, when he looks back on the ruin his life's become, he's going to remember Edward Rooney.
And remember not to be Edward Rooney.
Yep. And here in the background is Big Audio Dynamite.
Oh, yep. Bad.
Mm-hmm. Yep. That's what BAD stands for, Big Audio Dynamite.
Yep, yes it does.
Wrong. Mm. We're not here. We're not
Cameron disapproves.
Here.
Seems like a perfectly decent garage.
Cameron, what's going to happen to it? It's in a garage. It could get wrecked.
It could get stolen. Scratched.
Breathed on wrong.
A pigeon could shit on it. Who knows?
I'm going to give the guy a fiver to watch it. Okay. I forget what this guy's name is, but he pops up every once in a while.
Yeah.
Like he's in Strange Days.
Yes.
And
he's one of those. He's kind of like what's his name?
What country do you think this is?
What's the actors I'm thinking of?
See, this is a thing in Chicago, you guys.
Yeah.
South Park is like not a thing in Chicago at all. So it's constant, and even in garages. In a garage, you don't self park your car. You give it to, like, a valet, and they take it. Even though you could perfectly, easily park your own car. It's not a thing in Chicago. So.
Yeah, that guy reminds me of Danny Trejo that he reminds me of.
He's, like, kind of a Danny Trejo, like, before Danny Trejo went to prison.
Yeah.
It would be this guy.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Danny Trejo's in prison?
He was.
Oh, he was, yeah. Because they're saying Let's see, he was just on The Flash not that long ago.
See what a Finsky can do to a guy's attitude? Yeah.
Good.
Oh. Cameron. He needs to have some fun.
White socks with brown shoes, not a good look.
It's not the greatest look in the world, but, no. You know. Yeah, man, let's go.
Go,
let's
go, 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 go. Yeah, man, hey, we're gonna have to do that again.
On your soundtrack, is yes. The Star Wars theme on there?
It should be, but they don't. It hasn't happened yet.
I know. I'm just asking.
Yeah. I haven't watched this version.
So now, Mrs. Bueller is suspicious.
This is my first time watching it on digital like this.
Because
normally I'm watching my Blu-rays. Okay. Yeah, she does kind of look like she does a little bit like 80s Lindsay Wagner.
Yeah, Lindsay Wagner, yeah.
A little bit.
Oh, look at this house with all its buildings and stuff.
Mm-hmm.
So she's suspicious. And I remember we were, as kids, thinking like, our moms would be all in, like, opening the windows and like, how are you feeling?
Apparently, Ferris should be an engineer because to pull off the whole thing with the dummy and the rigging the, you know, the pulley system and whatnot. Yeah, he should definitely be an engineer.
He's pretty.
Nine times.
So I love how she, like, she second guesses herself, but then it opens the door, but, like, doesn't go in any further.
Yeah.
You know?
Well, because that would blow it.
I understand.
The story, doesn't allow her to go into that room. Because if it did, the whole jig would be up.
Yeah. Les jus sont faits.
The juice en fait.
Oh my goodness gracious. I like want all of those posters.
It's pretty
stacked. It's cool.
You like that print?
I do.
Meanwhile, at the Sears Tower.
Uh-huh. Here, these are the cars okay?
Back when it was the Sears Tower.
The world's tallest building. I don't feel so good. Can we go home soon?
1,353 up in there. Cameron, there you go. The city looks so peaceful from up here.
Boop. Stock market.
Stock market.
Yep.
I love Cameron doing the Three Stooges.
His Three Stooges
riff.
Yeah.
I totally memorized that.
Me too, I know, right?
Yep. Because I'm a huge Stooges fan.
I love how distressed the chaos of the stock market is making Ferris.
Yeah.
And I love Cameron's drippy noises. And I would love to know what happened to Ferris.
I'm so jealous. I would love to be able to do that.
I know, right? What? I want to know what happened to Ferris and Sloane.
Yeah.
Having no place to live. You feeling awkward about only the cheerleader being the only cheerleader or the husband? Give me one good reason why not. I'll give you two good reasons why not. My mother and my father. They're married and they hate each other. You've seen them, am I right? It's like that car. He loves the car.
He hates his wife.
He hates his wife. Whoop.
Whoop.
Whoop. Oh, Shiki. Chiqui, bonjour.
Yes. So here we have the classic Abe Froman sausage king of Chicago.
For Froman party of three. Can we please get the hell out of here? This place gives me the creeps. I love this guy. Yes. Well, you can sure as hell try. Ed Froman on party of three for 12. He gives him a dollar, and he just sort of laughs.
Throws it around. The Sausage King of Chicago.
Sausage King of Chicago. Yeah.
This is Jonathan Schmuck, by the way.
That's
the maitre d'.
Why don't you take the kids and go back to the clubhouse?
To the clubhouse.
No, we demand to be seated. Are you suggesting that I'm not who I am?
You have to get snooty.
Snooty?
Snooty?
Snotty.
Snotty. Snotty.
I'm okay, let's go. I'm not going anywhere.
Going anywhere. I need to be seated.
Go ahead. You know what? In fact, I'll call him myself.
The police.
You're going to call police on me?
In fact, I'll call them myself.
Yeah, bye.
It'll be a hoot.
It'll be a hoot. Call the police. Give me the phone. I have another call. This is one of my favorite lines in this movie coming up right here.
You can never do this today because of line waving.
Touch me, I yell rat. I love that.
So find it.
This is the phone around here somewhere. Find it.
Oh, here's the line. I weep
for the future.
I still use that to this day, everybody.
Mm-hmm. Could we just go, please?
And it's my prerogative as Generation X looking at millennials going, I weep for the future.
I weep for the future. Well, actually, it's looking at Gen Z. Millennials have enough to worry about. That's A, true. You can never go too far.
And B, if I get busted,
it's not going to be by a guy like that. Abe. Ask for Abe Froman.
The Sausage King of Chicago.
I like how she describes what he's wearing and not how he actually looks.
Yeah.
Leather jacket, white t-shirt, sweater vest. Devastatingly handsome. Yeah. Yes, thank you. She's so good.
Right.
She's so cute.
She is. She's adorable.
He's like, I wonder what's going on over here.
Yeah, let's check that other line just to be sure.
It's a Froman.
This is Sergeant Peterson, Chicago Police.
He's got like one voice.
Yeah. But it works. He didn't know.
I know, right? I appreciate your understanding.
Understanding that makes it possible for a person like us to a person like yourself.
To tolerate a person like yourself. Thank you. Don't mention it. God. Enjoy your lunch. Like, Charles, I have to ask you.
Yes. Yes.
Considering the fact that you grew up in a diner.
Mm-hmm. I grew up in a family restaurant, not a diner.
Kind of fancy pants crap.
Do I what? What was that?
But you grew up in like a family style restaurant, not like a fancy pants restaurant like this, though, right?
No, I did not grow up in a fancy pants restaurant like this. No.
Isn't like diner family style?
It was more of like a family restaurant.
Diner food better than like.
Yes, it is. Yes, it is. I would take a diner over a French restaurant any day. Any day of the week. But that's me.
Are you?
What makes him so goddamn special? Screw him.
It was the only one that had weirdness in it. And I saw how Cameron's family operated. His home life was really twisted.
I like how the bathroom attendant is ignoring the fact that Ferris is breaking the fourth
wall.
He's not
even listening.
Yeah.
Uh-huh. He's the only guy I know who feels better when he's sick. If I had to live in that house, I'd probably pray for disease, too. Place is like a museum. It is very beautiful,
cold.
Very cold, and you're not
allowed to touch anything.
I also love how his dad is in the bathroom.
Yes.
But he doesn't... Can you appreciate what it's been like for Cameron to be in that joint as a baby? I'm actually amazed I got the car out of the garage.
I like the guy near him is annoyed with his little lip smacking.
I love how, like, Cameron is basically the Blues Brothers in this scene. I love driving it. It is so choice.
Your women! Bring us your women!
How much for the little girl?
How much for the little girl?
Your daughters. Send me your children. Mint? I say that every time I take a mint out of a mint bowl at a restaurant.
You can't help it, right?
Every single time. This is like the worst job in the world because I'm not going to tell you that. I seriously doubt it. When's he back? What's that supposed to mean? It means it's personal and it's none of your business, young lady. Wow, I got drunk fast.
Yeah. Bitch! Yeah. Nice attitude.
Nice attitude. Isn't Mrs. Hagel expecting you in consumer ed class? Yeah,
probably.
I love how Jeannie essentially... what a little asshole.
Yep.
Jeannie essentially takes the day off here, too.
Yeah. So. Well, she...
yeah. And I love how they're just standing there.
Well, yeah. Well, if you
two
notice,
restaurants in the Jeannie, area, I picked the one my father goes to.
Well, if you notice, Jeannie is like a cynical version of Ferris.
Jeannie is the perfect Gen
Only
Xer,
the
meek get totally
pitch.
Cynical.
Yes.
Bold survive.
Never.
I love how Cameron can't snap. He's like trying, but he can't really. Wait, Dave, you're the biggest guy in this business.
And obviously, Ferris' dad is completely oblivious here.
Mm-hmm. We have the money. We know we have the money. We just have to spend it. That's all, you bonehead.
You bonehead. Hero on patrol.
God. I love how Mr. Rooney cares so much about what Ferris is. Yes! Yeah. Why does Mr. Rooney give such a shit about what Ferris is doing? Because, like, this
oh,
is
the,
a great
ooh, the flip-ups. Flip-ups.
Oh, Ira Newborn. You do such good work.
Yep.
And I love how he thinks that this is where Ferris is going to go. Into Chicago to buy pizza. Like, you can't just get pizza any fucking where.
Yeah.
You know?
Well, he thinks he knows where all the hip teen hangouts are.
And, okay, I'm going to tell you this right now, everybody. Yeah. This leather jacket was not that popular.
No.
It's like, he's acting like you see this jacket everywhere, but you... If this jacket was, like, at the mall somewhere, I would have found it, okay? And Charles, I don't know...
Well, apparently it was in Chicago. Apparently it was in Chicago.
I've never seen it before.
Your ass is mine.
What is it like Polybius, where it was only in like Seattle? Oh. And then now it's Pat Benatar.
Yep.
So about 10 years later that he is just a creep. And he knows what's coming.
She's got a hint of Melinda Kalia as well. From A Team. From A Team.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, we're playing comes together.
Even Pac-Man.
Hey, bada, 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 bada,
swing, bada.
Bada. Do I even want to begin to talk to you, Charles, about how much I fucking want pizza right now?
How much do you fucking want to have pizza right now?
Like a lot. Foul territory.
Right. And Ferris is on TV. Yes. Rooney oblivious to it.
And he looks up and Ferris is gone.
Yep.
Yeah. Nothing.
Who's winning?
The Bears.
The Bears.
The Bears, by the way, are not a baseball team.
I love you. There's a little wind up and yeah.
Woo!
I've never to this day have yet to catch a foul ball. And it pisses me off.
So we
swing bada.
Come on.
Hey, bada, 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 swing, bada. You can't, you can't, you can't, you can't, you can't, swing, bada. Gotta do that part.
Safe Ferris.
Safe Ferris.
Wrigley Field, by the way, is located at 1060 West Addison in Chicago.
1060 West Addison. Isn't that Wrigley
Field? Wrigley Field.
Nice Blues Brothers reset, right? There should be a crossover with this movie.
What are you going to do now, Mr. Hot Rodder? Those cops got your address. No, they don't got my address. I falsified my renewal. I put down 1060 West Addison. 1060 West Addison, that's Wrigley Field.
If I had a gym coach like racing me around a track with driving a golf cart, I would punch that guy.
Love those sunglasses.
Those are badass, right?
I hate him.
Let me park by this fire hydrant.
That is a fire hydrant, and that is going to come into play later.
Is that a Reliant K? Right,
It might actually be a K car.
Yeah, it looks like a K car.
Yeah. I'm going to tell you something right now. Yeah. This was my answering machine message when I was in college.
Oh, nice.
Yeah. Who is it?
This should be everybody's answering machine message.
Uh-huh. I love how he's just a little foreshadowing here. He's singing Donka Shane in his head. Mm-hmm. Yeah. It's Ed Rudy Ferris. I have a word with you. You would think that once he found out that it's at the door right now, yep. I'm afraid that in my weakened condition,
I did subject myself to
taking a nap and slid down the stairs.
Subject myself to further school absences. Yeah.
Just get down here. You can reach my parents at their places of business. Thank you for stopping by. I appreciate your concern.
Ooh, Maxell tapes. Cassette tapes. Day.
Yeah. You would think that once he found out Ferris was sick, he wouldn't care. Like, Ferris is still at home, so who gives a shit?
Yeah.
This was a thing, you guys. Back in the 80s, intercoms houses
were
a thing. Like, you would have intercoms on your doorbell, and you could talk to, like, hey, Mom, can you bring me some soda? Or something. You know, you could do that. And I always thought that was so freaking cool.
Now, here's
cool.
where the jig is up, right here, because...
You know goddamn well who it is!
He's on the phone right now.
So Mr. Rooney has figured out that this is a recording...
It's like, that son of a bitch.
I think I've had about 5 shots of whiskey, Charles.
Well, you sound great.
Yeah, that's good.
You're doing good. Yeah. Internet wasn't doing that good. I think your internet was more drunk than you are.
Yeah, I think my internet fell out there for a minute, so I apologize for that. It fell out earlier today, too, so I apologize.
It's all right. Stupid internet.
Mr. Rooney. Left your wallet on the kitchen floor. I love Mr. Rooney walking through the mud.
Yes.
He loses his shoe. I mean, this is so friggin' illegal.
Yes.
Like, ooh, mud. Like, he's trying to look in the windows. First of all, Ferris Bueller's room is, like, the other side of the house.
But he doesn't know that. He doesn't know.
It's upstairs.
Yeah. He's just trying to peek inside the house to see if he can see him. God. This must be the only open window.
Shoe gets stuck in there, and he
then he puts his foot in it, so it's all over his sock and his slacks.
You son of a bitch!
Turns on the water hose.
Yep.
Well, at least he can clean his socks off.
And now we know why there's mud all over there, because that hose has just been down there leaking.
Yeah, apparently.
Yeah, shoe gets stuck in the mud, like it's like totally like suctioned in there.
Splorch.
And here Mr. Rooney rips his pants.
Yep.
You can see he's got ripped pants.
What?
He at least has the hose there to wash
his shoe off. Yeah.
And he realizes. Yeah, but now he realizes that his shoe, split pants. And now he's got
Star Wars theme.
Star Wars theme, everybody.
Even the guys that just go joyriding the car, they're just joyriding.
Yeah.
They're not doing anything. They're not, like, using it to...
No, they're just driving around in an awesome car.
Yeah, they're not, like, using it to jack up a convenience
store
or something.
Mr. Rooney now realizes that there is a doggy door in this house.
Like, oh, maybe I could go in there.
Yeah, which is a little bit demeaning, if you ask me, especially with a giant rip in your pants like that.
But you kind of wonder why other burglars haven't tried this in their neighborhood.
Well, there's a reason.
Because you can't fit.
And there it is, right there.
But, I mean, if you got somebody small, like a kid, to put them in.
I know, but
a
fucking Rottweiler, dude?
Well, there's
that. Rottweiler, yeah. There.
Yeah.
Hi, doggy!
Drool.
Say. Heel! Shit! See, that's the thing. The doggy door...
Yeah.
It's for the gigantic Rottweiler. Hey! And here we have the Chicago Art Institute, everybody.
Yep.
Where I spent my 30th birthday.
Did you really?
I sure did. Yep. I went to Chicago for my 30th birthday.
I've never been I've been to Chicago, but I have not been to this museum.
Yeah, I wanted to go to the Art Institute because it's a really, really cool museum.
Yep.
And I love this, that they're all just with this. That is my, Charles, that is my computer wallpaper, by the way.
Okay.
But mine has a TARDIS in the background.
Excellent.
Yeah. So, one of the neat things about this museum is that part of the reason I wanted to go is because Grant Wood's American Gothic is at this museum.
Okay.
And I wanted to see American Gothic, and it was touring on my birthday. So we have a picture of me standing next to the sign that says this exhibit is touring. It was kind of a little bit of a letdown, but the first time I ever saw...
I like how they're mimicking the pose here.
Uh-huh. First time I ever went to this museum, I was walking through. I only had like a half an hour. This is what I was looking
for. I love that painting, by the way. Yeah, I love that painting.
I wanted to see the stained glass right here, and I wanted to see the Surratt because of this movie. Like I said, this movie really shaped my psyche, and I'm just realizing it now how much of this movie is who I am today. I wanted to go to the stained glass room, and I wanted to see the Surratt. And as I was walking through the museum, I, out of the corner of my eye, saw somebody I knew. At least I thought I did, but when I went back to the other room to see who it was American Gothic.
Oh, nice. Zoom in.
So pointillism, everybody. Pointillism.
That was Dream Academy, everybody.
Dream Academy, yep.
Please, please, please let me get my
Did I ever tell you, Charles, about the boyfriend I got because of Dream Academy?
No.
Well, when I was in college, I worked at Media Play. Like, that's how long ago this was.
Yes, I
worked at Media Play.
You told me that.
Yeah. And this guy came in one time and he was asking for a song by Dream Academy. It was Life in a Northern Town, which was their big single.
Yeah.
And I told him, I said, okay, Life in a Northern Town, Dream Academy, that record never came out on CD. And it hadn't at the time. It had not come out on CD.
Yeah.
And so I said, listen, do you have a record player? Because I would send people who still had record players for, because they would come in looking for 80s music that never got me, that never got put on CD. And I said, do you have a record player? He said, yes, I do. I said, well, you need to go downtown, or you need to go down to just north of campus to Goldmine Records and ask that guy for Dream Academy and he will help you out. And he found that record and he came back and he told me,
over there.
Yeah. It's like, how does this happen?
Yeah.
Yeah.
A city this big, a city the size of Chicago, literally.
I also want to know, like, does he not recognize his son's girlfriend?
Apparently not.
I guess not.
At least he's not creeping on her.
She's just creeping
on him. She's creeping on him at this point.
Yeah. Yeah.
Hi.
But he's not pulling the, he's not pulling Jeffrey Jones. So the guy, let me find my romantic 1990s. I appreciate that.
Yes, there we go. Matthew Broderick was literally tickling her, by the way, to make that scene work.
Yep, baseball shame and cocaine. I love this evil eye he gives the dog through the door.
Squint.
Cameron, he wouldn't ditch us.
Why would he? He would not go back to school. Yeah. Just to make me sweat.
He did.
Such a wonderful crowd. We'd like to play a little tune for you.
Cameron, come on.
It's one of my personal favorites.
Proud. Go to the markets. I'd like to dedicate it to a young man who doesn't think he's seen anything good today.
Cameron Frye, this one's
Cameron
for you.
Cameron Frye, this one's for you.
Dankeschön.
And this is a Wayne Newton, everybody, who was a child, prodigy, and now who is a Vegas staple.
Lounge lizard. Yes. The place we'd meet, second seat. The first time I heard this song, I thought a woman sang it, to be honest with you.
Oh, yeah. I think he's about 13 when he sang this song.
Obviously, before puberty.
Oh, yeah. He was a big deal as a kid. Darling, don't explain.
Central Park and Farm. How you tore your dress. What a mess. That's not all.
I seriously think this is why most of Gen X has any sort of affinity for Wayne Newton.
Yeah, probably. Even just as a kitschy way.
Ferris can handle anything. This is one of my favorite lines.
Yep.
College. Yeah, but to be what? What do you think Ferris is going to do? I think he's going to be a fry cook on Venus. That's like my favorite line in this whole movie.
Nothing.
Me neither.
Hooray for indecisiveness.
You're crazy.
And now let's turn it up a little bit.
Here's the Beatles. Twist and shout.
Yes.
Fry cook on
the shake it up, baby, now.
We still don't have, like, fast-food restaurants on Venus, which makes me sad.
Yep.
Charles, you know what else makes me sad?
John Lennon being dead?
No, that it's curfew and I can't go get pizza.
Oh, yeah. Yeah,
I should have thought this through.
It's past 10 o'clock right now in Columbus, Ohio. We are in curfew because of stupid COVID. So.
Stupid COVID.
I love how suddenly we have a bunch of choreographed people coming along.
I know, I love them all.
So, apparently during the parade, several of the people that are seen dancing in that, including the construction worker and the window washer guy, they were just random people dancing along to the music that was being played during that scene. And John Hughes thought it was so funny that he just left him in the movie. He told the camera guys to record it. So I thought that was pretty cool.
Yeah, that's super cool. John Hughes is an extra somewhere, but I agree. She loves me now.
Shake it up, baby. Twist and shout.
Twist and shout.
Come on, baby, now. Come on and work it on out. This movie's probably one of the reasons why I love the Beatles.
Seriously, this movie is a major, major influence on me in my formative years.
This is probably what made me a Beatles
fan. Paul Ferris' dad is just jamming to this.
Yeah. Well, it's so infectious. Everybody wants to get along to it. Dance along. This one girl is really into it here. The one dancer in front.
Oh, yeah, these lederhosen dancers.
Yes.
They're so into it.
The blonde is really into it.
And I like how the woman playing the accordion is just still playing the accordion.
Yes. Well, she's got her thing going. And he falls back.
So great. Good job, Ferris. The black shop.
How can you not love that scene? It's impossible not to love that scene.
I love this right here. The faculty at school.
Faculty and staff. The English department. Yep. Best for a speedy recovery.
Okay. Dun, 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 dun. Flick, flick.
Yeah.
Poochie, poochie, poochie.
Here, Poochie.
Look what Uncle Ed's got for you, little fucker.
Little fucker. Little fucker. So apparently Uncle Ed is really into animal abuse.
Genie driving the Fiero. I don't even know what this car is.
What would have happened if he would have killed that dog?
Jesus. The ending would have been a lot less funny.
Yeah, pretty much. It's pretty dark.
Squeal. Also, why is he still fucking there, you know?
He's just waiting for Ferris to show up, I guess. Yeah?
Pretzels are delicious.
What?
Pretzels are delicious.
Yes, they are. I'm a big
I knew it!
I'm a big pretzel guy. Yeah, I'm a big pretzel guy. I like, I'm excellent at making the homemade soft pretzels.
Talking about this now.
Oh, look. This is called Breaking and Entering, by the way.
I know, right? All for one truant student? I mean, come on.
Yes, yes. So let's see. He's assaulted a dog. He's breaking and entering.
He's parked. He's still parked in front of a fire hydrant.
Right. And he's about to get booted to the head by a genie here.
Mm-hmm. I love how genie sneezed down the stairs because she thinks it's Ferris.
Yes. Well, she's trying to catch him, and he's trying to. Rooney's trying to catch Ferris as well. And then they run into each other.
That, by the way, is exactly how I sneak into a room, like on the sides of my feet. Like,
see, sneakers for sneaking.
Sneakers are for sneaking. Sneak, sneak, sneak.
Sneak, sneak, sneak.
Ferris.
Bueller. They're both trying to catch him, and they run into each other.
Yep.
And I love Judy's face here.
Ha!
One, two, doosh, doosh, doosh.
Ah! He just lands on the floor.
Yeah.
Whack. And then the feet just fall apart.
And there's the ticket. There's the first ticket.
Our first of like 900 tickets.
Yeah.
For parking in front of a fire.
Now look at the background. Here comes the car.
Garage, really funny. Here comes the car from like not in the garage.
Yep. Oh, hey, we're just pulling this up.
I can't believe that I was in a parade. Anybody who would nail me wouldn't go to a parade. My mother would. I'm not worried about your mother. A1 Easy Park.
Yes.
You know that place is on level. Easy Park.
Just remember that. Next time you're in Chicago, avoid that parking garage.
Unless you want Easy Park. Yeah, just take it. Don't take a nice car there because they'll take it out.
Unless you're able to take the miles off somehow. Crack open the odometer.
You'll drive home backwards. Yeah, man, we gotta do this again.
You can tell that it wasn't the first time, though, they did that.
There is an intruder. Male, location, possibly armed, certainly weird, in my kitchen. Look, it's real nice that you hope my brother's feeling better, okay? I'm very cute, and I'm very alone, and I'm very protective of my body. I don't want to... murdered or killed, all right?
Spiggity English?
Spiggity English?
Dickhead!
Dickhead! Charles, there used to be something so satisfying about slamming a phone down. Remember that?
Right, yep. That's the problem with cell phones. You can't slam them down like you used to.
I know, you can only push the hang up. Excuse me, whoever's still in the house, still in the house. I'd just like you to know that I've called the police. So if you have any sense whatsoever, you get your ass out of my house real quick. I'd also like to add that I have a father's gun and a scorching case of herpes.
That sounds like a personal problem.
I love how that's what makes him leave, is a scorching case of herpes. Like,
drops
like he
his
has
wallet.
Any chance with her.
There goes the wallet.
I got my keys! You shit!
Let me... Well, because you did, you could run after it faster.
Not with his chewed up. Not with his chewed up ankle, he can't.
Yeah, he's kind of limping there, but. Well, he had a chance, but he blew it.
Yep. The thing is, he should have not parked in front of a fire hydrant in the first place.
No. No. Apparently it was quota day by the police, though. Their ticket quota.
Right. Yeah, exactly. I like how here's where Cameron goes berserk.
Ferris is doing the math in his head. Wait a minute.
Mm-hmm.
And here's where Cameron goes berserk.
126 and halfway between 3 and 4 tenths. Why, how many miles are on it now? Oh, Cameron.
Here's where Cameron goes berserk. I can't do that because my lungs won't let me.
practice that like way more times than I care to admit.
if my lungs weren't so jacked up, I could be able to do that.
I am not proud of how many times I've practiced that yell.
That's impressive, though. I could do it for a little bit, obviously, but I couldn't do it the whole run.
Yeah, it's not
like I used
to. You should be proud of. Yeah, no. Nothing you should be proud of. God bless the police. I think you're the best.
Oh.
Louis Anderson, everybody.
Louis Anderson, Louis Anderson. Yep. Right there, the flower pot guy. Yep.
What exactly are Louis Anderson and that other guy there for? Because I'm the nurse who likes to.
Abruptly cut off.
I love the nurse who likes to.
Yes.
The nurse who likes to is like one of my favorite things about this movie.
We always like the nurse who likes to.
Totally. This could very well be for real.
Might have blown a microchip, because microchips were big back in the 80s, you guys.
Camera's always been a little keyed up.
In case you're wondering what a microchip is.
It's still a thing.
Not really.
It's not as big as a thing. This is what high school was like. You know, you went to one school, your friend went to another, and back in the days before email, it was hard to stay in touch, man.
Yeah, pretty much. At least Sloane's showing concern here for Cameron.
Ferris is concerned, too. He just doesn't know what to do.
Yeah.
Ferris, this isn't working. We better try something else.
We better take off our clothes and jump in a pool.
At least nobody's ever been in love with him.
Yeah.
But things
gonna marry the first girl he lays.
The first girl he lays.
And she's going to treat him like shit.
She would have given him what he has built up in his mind as the end all be all of human existence. She won't respect him. Because you can't respect someone who kisses your ass. It just doesn't work.
Doesn't work.
Charles, do you know anybody like this?
No, not at all. No.
Somebody very, very close to me.
Yeah.
Married the first girl he laid, and she treats him like shit to this day.
Was it Cameron Frye?
I wish I knew Cameron Frye. It's okay. Sooner or later, everybody goes to the zoo, which makes no fucking sense whatsoever. I go to zoo all the time, and I don't stand.
I think she's trying to say everybody goes kazoo.
And I know, but
the subtitle, does it wrong. Like kazoo, like crazy. Kazoo,
I'm
crazy.
I want Oreos now.
Yep.
I want pizza and Oreos. Why didn't I plan ahead, Charles?
I don't know. I didn't. I forgot the gummy bears. So. They're not real nice and warm in my pocket.
It's a holiday weekend. We're not on a game. Yeah,
pretty much. At least we remember the beer. Or bourbon.
Mm-hmm. Whiskey. And the pretzels.
Whiskey. Yeah, the pretzels.
See, Ferris cares about Cameron.
Yeah.
You worried about him.
Cared about him to keep him from drowning in the pool. Yeah. Ferris Bueller, you're my hero.
You're my hero.
You're my
hero. Oh, shit, Cameron, come on.
Blink, blink.
Oh, where's that?
Ferris Bueller, you're my hero.
You're kidding? Oh.
Oh, you son of a bitch.
You son of a bitch. It's not just funny. Is that Cameron's underwear or Ferris's underwear, or does he just have?
No, that's his vest. Yeah, that's his vest that he wrapped around as.
Is it?
Oh, yeah.
Okay.
You know, there's
okay,
that.
So this is you guys. So we're back in Shermer. Welcome to the fictional town of Shermer, Illinois. Charlie Sheen, everybody!
It's Mr. Hot Shots himself.
Can you still not hear me?
I can hear you a little bit. Can you hear me?
All right. So Charlie Sheen, everybody. No problem. I'm going to eat more pretzels and wait for the Skype to decide to fix itself.
You wear too much eye makeup.
My sister wears too much. People think she's a whore.
Do you think I should wear glasses and pitch for the Indians?
Wild things.
You make my heart sing.
God. I know what's wrong. I just want to hear you say it. I love how her therapist is Charlie Sheen.
Yeah. he's like the Zen drug guy.
No, not yet.
The Zen drug addict. Here.
I know. He's so perfect. See, I went home to confirm the dickhead was shithead was sleeping fishy school. When I was there, a guy broke into the house and the guy called the cops and they picked me up for making a phony phone call.
What do you care if your brother ditches
school?
Why
should he get to ditch when everybody else has to go?
You could ditch.
You could ditch? Yeah. I'd get caught.
So you're pro... I see.
So you're pissed off because he ditches
and doesn't get caught. Is that it?
Basically.
Basically.
Then your problem is you.
It is you.
Excuse me?
Excuse you.
You spend a little more time dealing with yourself. Less time worrying about what your brother does. That's just an opinion. What are you, a psychiatrist? No. Then maybe you should keep your opinions to yourself.
This look is hilarious.
Somebody you should talk to.
If you say Ferris Bueller, you lose a testicle.
You lose a testicle. Oh, you know him.
Oh, you know him. Crunch. Crack. Knuckle crack.
And here we are trying to drive home backwards.
Concrete
Kids,
block.
This does not work, by the
no,
way.
No, no. Don't try this at home.
This does not work. No. Does not work. The whole time I was just thinking things over, you know. I was like...
If you steal your dad's 1961 Ferrari 250
GT California
Spider.
You got to take the heat.
Yeah, you got to take the heat. You may not want this much heat, but you need to take the heat.
You know, when Morris comes home, you're going to have a little chat.
Yep.
Wishing I was dead. All that shit.
This is Cameron's big breakthrough here.
This is a very serious moment. Cameron figures out his life. This is the best day of my life. You know, Cameron, I'm going to miss you guys next year. You know, that's the thing about college, man. You go to a college, your friends go to a different college.
Right. Unless you guys were going to the same college, then otherwise, yeah, it'd be
right.
Just like that.
Yeah.
Now, obviously, like you said, it's going to be easier if you got email, which we didn't have back in the day.
I did in college. You've seen me change all my clothes in my jacuzzi? Thought you were catatonic. He doesn't want to. He doesn't want to fess up to it, which is a little creepy, Cameron. Yeah. I'll give you that. That's okay. I'm not embarrassed.
I can't fault him. He's in high school.
Sloane here.
Every hetero high school boy would have done that. Yeah.
I got to say, I love Sloane here for just owning herself. You know? She's like, I changed my clothes in front of you. Whatever.
She says, I'm not embarrassed.
I'm not embarrassed. Good for her.
Yep.
She has no reason to be embarrassed. Right. Hey, fast!
Yeah.
Miles aren't coming off.
I love how he walks out all calmly. Yeah.
Miles aren't coming off going in reverse. That has never worked, ever. That's not a thing.
Huh.
Well, I guess we're going to have to crack open the odometer, roll it back by hand, which, by the way, is highly illegal to do.
Yes, yes. Don't do that.
Highly illegal to do.
Don't do that. We don't recommend that here.
No. That is against all car sales laws, anything like that. It's highly, highly illegal. I got to take a stand. I got to take a stand against him. Got to have a little moment here for my bullshit.
This is my old
man pushes me around.
He puts up with everything. Pushes me around.
And never say anything!
Never say anything!
See, I think this is why he's not the problem. I'm the problem. I think this is why I fell so in love with Cameron.
Yeah. Well, he has the biggest breakthrough in this movie.
He has such an epiphany.
Yeah.
And he has real problems. I mean, Ferris doesn't like to go to school. I mean, everything works out for him.
But Cameron Cameron has the most character growth.
If the events affect me in my life to determine the course of my life unfold, I'm going to take a stand. I'm going to defend it, right or wrong, I'm going to defend it. And he has this epiphany, and he figures himself out, and I love Cameron for this.
Yep.
The scene is really.
What do you love? You love a car.
Yeah, Alan Ruck does such a good job, and he's like, no, let him.
Stand back.
I'm so sick of his shit. I hate this goddamn car.
You love a car.
I love a car.
Son.
And Ferris holds her back. He's like, no, he's got to get this out. Like. Ferris really does, in fact, love Cameron. He really does care about him, and he knows.
And he stops himself right here at this moment.
Yeah, right here.
Just when the car is on the teetering point on its back brake.
And Cameron is not wrong. You know, he has a father who loves a car above his son, above his wife, above his only child. You know, that is misplaced priorities right there. I mean, yeah, love your car. Love your collection, you know, revel in your collections and everything, but your family is more important.
Exactly.
I can't hide this. Alan Ruck, so fucking good.
See, I love my collections too, but there's no way I would be that more focused on an inanimate object than I would my family.
Yeah, exactly.
You gotta have your priorities.
Right. You know, hell with him. Oh, Cameron. Can't wait to see the look on the bastard's face.
And there it goes.
Oh, no. No.
Whee!
Oh, my God.
As someone who grew up appreciating fine cars because my father was a big car appreciation guy Yeah, I kind of cringed at that the first time I saw it.
What did I do?
You killed the car.
You killed the car.
Which is one of the best lines ever.
Uh-huh. Oh, I love how they just both look like, yeah, there's no.
Yeah, it's,
I love this
she's
look
like,
on
no,
face,
this,
like, no, no, no.
Yeah, this real silent
I'm not gonna
no.
have it. What did I do? You killed the car. And frankly, you know, this is on Cameron. You know, he didn't have to kick the car.
No. He didn't have to do that final kick.
No, he did not.
Well, he didn't really kick it that final kick. He put his hands on it.
He just put his foot on it and rested.
Yeah, he just rested his foot on it.
Where he kicks the little piece of glass, and I love this POV scene of Cameron.
Yep. The camera work in this scene is exquisite, by the way.
Kick? Yeah.
Fantastic camera work. I love this movie so much.
This movie's so great. I love Cameron. Whoa. Holy shit. And they all just have no idea what to do here. But Cameron, he's got it all figured out. Cameron, it's my fault. I'll take the heat for this. When he gets here, I'll say I did it. He hates me anyway.
Yeah.
See, Ferris really does love Cameron.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, they are best friends. I'll take it. No. No, you don't want this much heat. No, I want it. If I didn't want it, I wouldn't look like
it. I think Ferris realized that he could probably talk his way out of it. If he had to.
I could have stopped, yeah. It is possible to stop Mr. Ferris Bueller, you know.
Come on.
I want it. I'm going to take it. When Morris comes home, he and I will just have a little chat. Oh, Cameron. That's the one thing about this whole story is I want so much more Cameron. I want to know more about what goes on with Cameron.
Yeah, unfortunately, this is the final scene right here.
And this is Cameron's final moment right there. Look at how beautiful that man is. That's a beautiful man right there.
I'll take your word
now, for it. Now, this is a scene where you watch the background.
Yes.
She must have had a pretty good scare. I love how the police show up and pick her up, but they don't find Mr. Rooney's wallet.
Yeah, right?
I mean, that is like a really hapless police force.
Great detective work. Like, none of them went into that house.
Not everybody here at the precinct are pulling for him, huh? Oh, right.
Right.
Yeah, whatever.
Okay. So what's she going to do when she sees Save Ferris painted on the water tower?
I know, right? Yeah. Hey, don't hide me, young lady. I want to get out of here now. Okay, okay.
Okay,
fine.
Okay.
Yes, okay.
Okay, okay.
Hey. It's a little hyper. Yeah.
Yeah.
Let's not ruin this with a lot of talk, okay? You didn't even tell me your name. Oh, well, it's Jean, but a lot of guys call me Shauna. Shauna!
Shauna!
Shauna! Ooh, Shauna! Jean.
Okay, Jean.
Jean. Shauna. Ooh, Jeanie, Shauna. I love this song in the background. Jeannie, come on, okay. Jennifer Grey.
Yeah.
Oh my God, she's such a gem in this movie. Dog of Shame.
Darling,
Dog of Shame.
So Jeannie kind of has her own breakthrough, though.
Yep, here we have The Edge of Forever again by the Dream Academy. Uh-huh. Oh, yeah, for the first time in his life. And we have, you know, Sloane's awesome house. You know what you were doing when you woke up this morning, didn't you?
Me? No.
Ferris. Hey, Charles, do you realize if we played by the rules today, we'd be in June? I'm just gonna eat more jelly beans. And Ferris has, like, what does he have, like, 6 minutes to get home?
Yep. Dun-dun-dun-dun.
I have to go. Call you tonight.
He's going to marry me.
He's going to marry me. Yeah, I love you, too.
Wee.
He's going to marry me. So cute. This right here.
Yep.
Is such a genius part of this movie.
Yeah, it's so well choreographed.
Mm-hmm.
When he's going through the house, and then when he grabs the beer.
I was about to close the damn deal with the Vermont people.
Yeah.
I'm going to take my commission and buy Ferris a car. Beanie, what are you doing? You're trying to get us killed?
Dun, 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 dun. And the competition is on. Squint, squint.
And here we have
yes.
dun, dun, the dun, English dun, beats dun, dun, dun. March of the Swivelheads.
Yep, March of the Swivelheads.
Which is a remake, or not a remake, but a remix of their song Rotating Head.
I was very disappointed that was not on the soundtrack, by the way.
I think that's on their special beat service record.
Yeah.
Rotating Head. And it's on a 12-inch of Save It For Later, maybe?
Okay.
I forgot. Let's look, because I think I have it somewhere.
I'm sure you do.
I love...
Grabs the beer. Right out of the guy's hand.
The only, montage chase scene that's better than this, mm-hmm. or even remotely the same as this, is...
have to stop a turn.
I can't. I
Hi,
can't
Ferris
think
Bueller.
Of anything right now. Hi,
Ferris Bueller.
How you doing? It's Raising Arizona, where he runs through everything.
Right.
I don't think I have this record anymore because I think it's somewhere else. But I think I might have a single. I don't know. I can't stand up for very long right now, Charles. I gotta sit back down.
Are you a little tipsy?
I had a lot of whiskey. She got a speeding ticket, another speeding ticket, and I lost a Vermont deal because of her. We should shoot her.
Did the whiskey win the war?
Yeah, I lost the battle.
You lost the battle?
I might win the war, but I lost the battle. I have to tell you a story, Charles.
This is me driving on Treby Road, by the way.
Yeah,
behind
exactly.
This guy.
I one time was driving to my friend Andrea's house.
Yes.
And literally this song was playing on my stereo because I had it on tape. And yeah. there was somebody going 10 miles in front of me. Yeah. It was the most hilarious moment.
I love the little skid sound effect.
Uh-huh. And he's like, hi, how you doing? God damn it. Dun, dun, dun,
dun, dun, dun. Ferris's dad is so oblivious.
He is so oblivious. He knows that's Ferris.
Right. He doesn't even recognize his own son running beside him.
He's like, wait a minute, is that my son? I don't know, whatever. He's gone now.
Yeah. Ooh, I look good in the mirror.
No, don't get up.
Yeah. It's just... Dinner's ready.
Dinner's ready. What? Who is that? He's like, nah. How?
Boing. Slow-mo.
Mm-hmm.
I'm amazed the shocks on that station wagon could hold up on that car.
Oh, yeah. Mm-hmm. A little town and country that she's driving around.
With the wood paneling. Nice.
Mm-hmm. Ooh, what's wrong?
I think we should shoot her.
Everything. I just picked up Jeannie from the police station.
Whoop, key's gone. Ticket.
I think we should shoot her. Mr. Rooney's still there. Looking for this.
Dun, 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 dun.
Charles, the Mad Magazine parody of this movie. Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Basically ended with Ferris saying, do you really want me in your school for another year? Oh, God, no. I never thought about it that way. Get you right where I want you. And so this movie proves.
Yes.
That no matter how much you hate your brother.
You hate the principal more. Hi, everybody. Surprise. Wink. Thank you, Mr. Rooney, for driving him home. What? Now, I want you to go upstairs and get in bed.
Proving once again that you love your brother more than you hate your principal more than you hate your brother, and you actually do love your brother.
Ferris is impressed by this.
Oh. Yeah. Scoot. Can you imagine someone as sick as Ferris trying to walk home from the hospital? Oh, kids. By the way, Mr. Rooney, you left your wallet on the kitchen floor. So now, you know, she could have just turned him in, but he,
yeah.
But she wakes up the dog instead.
And
the
I like how she throws the wallet in the mud.
Yeah.
Bloop.
Yeah!
It's nice to have a homicidal dog.
I know, right? Like, where did all these, like, who
brought nobody pays attention to where the flowers, right?
It's like, no, they're wondering where the flowers came from, but, like, the flowers have just been delivered all day,
yeah.
And, like, apparently the door has been unlocked. So.
Well, they figured Ferris could have gotten up, at least, to answer the door, I guess. Mm-hmm.
Ferris has left on his snoring stereo. Oops.
Don't. I kind of cringe when the baseball hits the stereo.
Uh-huh. I mean, that would knock.
Yep.
I mean, this is how heavy stereos used to be back in the day.
Yeah, I know.
Hit the power button, lands right in the, yeah.
In the glove.
Perfect.
Perfect.
Yep. Here we go. You got to check on him. He's still awfully warm because he's been running.
Right, exactly. He's been scrambling.
The neighborhood, yeah. 150%
better. Thank you.
Thank you. Don't make me stay home again. I have to graduate. I want to go to school. I have to graduate in June. And
what?
Ferris, you're sick. Don't go push it and make yourself worse, okay? You knew you were right, Dad. Yeah, I know I'm right, pal. How'd you get to be so sweet in years of practice? This is.
Yeah, he's laying it on a little thick here.
He's laying it on a little bit thick, yeah. Banky.
Yep. Let's try to bite her finger.
Bites the dad's finger.
Yeah. I thought it was, yeah.
So you know Ferris has been pulling this since he was like probably 5.
Oh, I'm sure, yeah.
Yeah.
He's got it down.
Yeah.
So.
Cabaret Voltaire. God. Whew. Yep.
Look to the camera.
I've said it.
Yep.
I've said it before and I'll say it again.
Life moves pretty fast. If you don't stop and look around once in a while, you could miss it.
You could miss it. And here, Charles.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Four
years chasing this kid. 4 years. It's making a fool of me. So when this movie was done on VHS in pan and scan.
Yes.
The whole screen was Mr. Rooney and the credits went up and just sort of faded out halfway.
Yeah, right.
What's going on? Did you get in a fight?
It's one of the reasons why we have like Blu-rays now and DVDs is because we need to see the whole thing as it was presented.
Well, and here's the thing about this. This movie, I think, taught us as a generation to stay for the credits.
Right. This is the first after credits. The big first big after credits thing. Yes. Marvel got their idea.
I mean,
We
had things in credits like, well, the first after credits that I remember, Charles, is Airplane.
That's right. Yeah, with Johnny, right?
No. At the very end, after all the credits, the guy in the cab is still there. And he's like, okay, I'm going to give that guy another 5 minutes.
Oh, that's right. That's right.
Mm-hmm.
You're absolutely right.
Who, by the way, was a Los Angeles politician. Who wanted to regulate taxis or something like that. That's why they had him in that scene.
Oh, nice little in-joke.
And in things like Airplane or the Kentucky Fried Movie, there were funny things in the credits. Like, they wrote funny things in the credits. Same thing with Monty Python and the Quest for the Holy Grail. There were funny things in the credits, but there wasn't this after-credit scene. So the first after-credit scene I remember is Airplane. I don't know what the first after-credit scene is, and I would look it up if I could type right now, but I can't because I'm
drunk. Right. Everybody else can go out and look it up if they want to.
They can Google that and tell
us
how
Google it.
Google it and report back to us. But this one, obviously, influenced a lot of people, because this is where we get the ending of Deadpool.
Bet you've never spelled a real school bus before.
A real school bus before. Which, by the way, Charles, I've never actually seen.
What, a school bus?
Deadpool.
Oh, Deadpool? I've got it, if you ever want to watch it.
Yeah, I'll watch it eventually.
The first one's really good.
I have problems with it, though, you know.
Yeah, I understand.
The real Dave Wakeling? Mm-hmm. Probably number 8 on my gimme list.
Okay, that's fair. Rooney eats it.
Rooney eats it. Yeah. I saw Dave Wakeling in concert a couple of years ago, and my God, that man is a great performer. He's fantastic.
Okay.
Say Ferris. Uh-huh. Those notebooks that were like that blue, like not quite denim, not quite any other fabric you've ever seen.
Say, that's a great name for a band.
Say Ferris? Oh, yeah, I've heard that before.
Yeah. And now, just when you're ready to walk out the theater.
Mm-hmm.
You're still here? It's over.
It's over.
Yep.
Go home.
This is Ferris Bueller's response to Donald Trump, by the way.
Yeah, go home.
It's over.
Go.
Go.
It's over. You lost. All right.
All right, that's our movie, everybody.
Ferris Bueller's Day Off, everybody.
It took a little struggle with the Skype tonight, but we got through it.
Yes, I apologize. My internet crashed.
Yeah.
So I'll have to check on it a little bit later. I am now on cell service trying to
get through this. Yeah.
Yeah.
So I hope everybody enjoyed our commentary, even though we just basically quoted the whole movie.
Yeah. But, you know, we gave some trivia.
Exactly. Try to make it a little more interesting, yeah.
Yeah, so, exactly.
So I do have a little bit more trivia that we didn't cover.
What do you got?
So just real quick, Cindy Pickett and Lyman Ward, who play Ferris's parents, apparently married in real life after filming
married
this movie.
Married in real life. Yes, they did.
But then they got divorced in 1992.
I know. It's very...
Yeah.
And
so it's very
sad. Matthew Broderick and Jennifer Grey,
right?
After this movie, became a real couple, and they were after Matthew and he killed somebody.
You kind of like sped up, you slowed down, and then you sped her up real fast on that one.
Okay,
do it again.
They were in France. They were in a car accident. And Matthew Broderick was driving and he killed somebody, vehicular homicide.
Yeah. Apparently it was a mother and a daughter died in the accident.
Yep. That's right. It was very sad.
Actually, and it was in Ireland, apparently, not France.
I thought it was France. Whatever. Ireland.
Yeah, it's close enough, right? It's Europe. It's Europe. It counts.
Yeah. Europe.
Same thing, right?
Exactly. Yep.
So, yeah, I'm sure that didn't work out that well. All right. So, let's see what else. Apparently, the idea of a sequel had gone around for years with Ferris in college or at a job somewhere. But apparently, they ditched the idea because Matthew Broderick didn't feel that this film needed a sequel. And I think he's right about that.
I think he's absolutely right.
Yep, I agree with him on this one.
Yep.
That was a good call. Didn't need a sequel ruining it and watering it down.
No, absolutely not.
Not this movie. So, just thought I'd mention those. Oh, and to have the desired druggy effect. For his role as a drug addict in the police station, Charlie Sheen stayed awake for more than 48 hours before they shot the scene.
Which is really funny because, you know, Charlie Sheen just was a drug addict in real life. He could have just been Charlie Sheen.
I know, right? He could have just been a normal drug addict.
He could have just been Charlie Sheen.
Yeah, exactly.
So,
exactly. All right. So what's your rating for this one?
Oh, boy. I should have thought of this beforehand. I'm going to say...
When you were more sober?
This one for me is 9 out of 10 nurses who like to fuck. Because
nice.
This movie, I feel like out of the John Hughes movie, yeah. I mean, there's a lot of... John Hughes movies, they don't age well because they're kind of rapey, some of them.
Yeah. You
know? Like Weird Science and especially Pretty in Pink. They're not Pretty in Pink. Weird Science is a little bit rapey.
Yeah.
Breakfast Club is a little bit rapey. But this one is not at all.
I don't remember any rapey. I don't remember. Yeah, I don't. That's as bad as it gets, as far as I'm concerned, in this movie.
Mm-hmm. But she totally owns it. She's like, yeah, whatever.
Yeah.
That's what I did, whatever. This movie, like I said, is quintessential Gen X viewing. If you want to understand Generation X, watch this movie.
Accurate.
Sort of quintessential kids in high school just not knowing what they're going to do with themselves. That whole idea of in the 80s when there was more emphasis on following who you are as yourself rather than like, I don't care who you are. You get a job, you get a family, you support them, and you die. And the idea that when you're 17, 18 years old, you don't know who the hell you are. You don't know what you want to do. You don't know who you want to be. So that whole idea of, I don't know what I'm going to do. I'm going to go to college, but I don't know to do what. I don't know why I'm going. I don't know what I want. So I feel like this movie really captures that idea of by the time, there are so many parts of your life that by the time you figure it all out, that part of your life is over.
Right.
You know, once, Ferris has figured out high school. But I don't know what Ferris is going to do in college. Ferris is going to get to college, and he's going to be a freshman, and there's going to be another senior that's another Ferris that's the alpha dog. And Ferris is going to be completely different.
Yeah.
And, you know, and just the idea of,
he won't be like he was in high school. He peaked in high school.
Right, right. I don't necessarily think he peaked in high school, but I think it's a good lesson of when you think you have it all figured out, you don't, because there's more that comes later.
Yeah.
You know, once you figure it all out, there's more that's going to happen. So there's that. There's also the idea of the, not necessarily the abusive parent, but the absent parent, which I don't think we've really talked about that much.
Mm-hmm.
We talked about it a little bit in film. We talked about it a little bit in, say, like Ordinary People, where yeah. you have the parent that just doesn't understand the child and therefore is not interested in the child. But that whole absent parent thing. And then you also address sibling rivalry, you know, that no matter what happens in a sibling rivalry at the end of the day, you're in it together. You're still, you know, no matter how much you think you might be against your sibling, at the end of the day, it's you and them against the adults. And I like that. Okay. And I like the fact that Ferris is this alpha dog character who everybody loves, who has the shit-eating grin, that has it all figured out. But he's still Matthew Broderick. He's kind of a nerd. He's not like...
He's a little relatable.
Ferris is not the captain of the football team. What makes him cool are the things that I always thought were cool, like his cool taste in music, his yeah. ability to work any situation. It's not that he's cool because he won the big game, you know?
Yeah, he's not like jock cool or...
Right.
Or preppy, right, preppy cool, or what have you, yeah.
Yeah, he's rich his kid own cool. thing. Yeah, he's his own, I mean, yeah, he's a rich kid.
He's a rich kid, but he doesn't act like a rich kid.
Yeah, he's very unique. He's his own, he is his own thing. And I think, like I said, I'm realizing watching this movie now, how much of this movie shaped me as a person.
Yeah.
Because I saw, like I said, I saw this during my formative years, I was 10 years old, and I loved it. And just that idea of you don't necessarily have to fit in to everybody's expectations to be the cool guy. I like that message.
Yeah.
What about you, Charles? What's your rating?
Well, as for me, first and foremost, I'm going to give it a 10 out of 10 because I absolutely love this movie.
Yeah, baby.
It's one of my all-time favorite movies. And
It's a fabulous movie.
So I give it a 10 out of 10. Demolished 1961 Ferrari 250 GT, California Spiders. Yeah. So.
Yep.
This was a movie that came around for me at a very transitional time in my life in high school.
You were like Ferris's age when this came out.
In a lot of ways. Yeah, exactly. I was 17 when this came out. And obviously I'm getting ready, I'm doing my, getting ready for my senior year of high school and soon to be off to college for me as well. So it was kind of like I was living Ferris and Cameron's life in a lot of ways. And I was more, I was more Cameron than Ferris, obviously. But this movie, with that simple, very simple message, life moves pretty fast. If you don't stop and look around once in a while, you can miss it. And for me,
excellent advice.
Yeah, it is. And it was advice that changed my life literally, because up until that point, around this time, until I hit my senior year of high school, I was the guy missing life. I was the one missing it. And when I saw this movie and I listened to it and it taught me to broaden my horizons, to not play it safe, to go out there, see more of life, experience it, appreciate it. Don't just stand by. And so for me, this is a great coming of age movie that transitioned me for the next stage of my life.
That's fantastic.
Going forward. Yeah. So I owe a great deal, and I used to have this big Ferris Bueller movie poster in my bedroom to remind me of this. And so it was one of these things that motivated me and to not take myself so seriously, to go out and enjoy life and get more out of it. And I wish I would have learned it a little sooner in life, but
the bold survive, Charles.
The meek get pinched, the bold survive. Exactly. So,
yep.
So yeah, I owe this movie a great deal of a great debt of gratitude. So yeah, I got to give it 10 out of 10 because it's one of those things that certain piece of art that comes around so often and changes your life and your entire perspective and your outlook going forward. So.
The only reason I feel like it loses any points for me is that there's such bad character development for Sloane. I feel like Sloane is just there to be in love with Ferris.
She is very underwritten.
Yeah, and I would have liked to have seen a little bit more of her character.
But I did like the fact that she and Cameron got to share a couple scenes.
I thought that was Ferris. Great.
Yeah.
Yeah, I thought that was great. I love that idea because that sort of
like that scene where they're walking along and
they're holding hands and they're having deep heart to heart.
They're talking about what do you want to do after high school? Nothing. I don't know what I want to do.
Yeah,
me too. They kind of bond over that a little bit.
Yeah, they really do. It's like they really do care. They care about each other and their common denominator is that they care about Ferris.
Yeah.
But I think their relationship is very cute. But I feel like Sloane is very underdeveloped, that's where it loses some points for me.
I agree with that. I think that's fair. But I guess, like I said, more of a sentimental thing for me. So
very sentimental favorite for me too. Like I said,
I may be biased in this one. So
I'm biased, but
I will own it. I will own it.
Like I said, I'm realizing watching this movie that my musical taste, my taste in who my favorite sports teams are.
Yeah.
Everything.
Was dictated by that movie.
How I like to wear my hair. How I like to wear. I mean, I kind of have Sloane hair. I always have. So, yeah, this movie has really imprinted on me quite a bit. Yeah.
So, believe it or not, after our first episode, we did get some email.
Yay!
We got the drunk mail from... The drunk mail from Dave Proctor, who was kind enough to write in, but this time about Ferris Bueller's Day Off. So,
what's up, Dave?
So, Dave, I want to thank you for writing in. You've been really good about writing in on the Phantom Zone, where we're talking the cool boys. And obviously, you just recently appeared on Next Stop Everywhere once again, where we talked the Doctor's Daughter. So that was a lot of fun.
Nice.
And hopefully I'll be getting that up this weekend. But Dave writes in about Ferris Bueller, says, I know this isn't one of my usual podcasts, but it may be now. When I heard you were going to be talking about one of my favorite movies, I had to listen in. So there's a fan theory. So I hope you're listening, Dave. There's a fan theory that Ferris is imaginary and Cameron is the one doing the imagining. I like this idea.
I have heard that theory. Yeah.
Yeah. Fan theories are, you know, when it comes to these movies, are pretty popular these days. So
Ferris is Cameron's Tyler Durden.
Yeah, that's exactly what he says here. It said a sort of teenage Tyler Durden.
Oh wow!
Yep.
And Dave apparently wrote the same wavelength.
Yeah, apparently you're both on the same wave, like same page here. He suffers so bad a want of love for his father that he has a mental episode that lets him live out a fantasy. He breaks the rules and has a hot girlfriend and gets noticed by his father for sure. So that's I don't think it's more fan theory. It's more fan fiction because I don't think that's what was intended in this movie. It's a pretty straightforward movie.
I don't think so either. Yeah.
But it's a fun thing to, you know, like, oh, hey, wouldn't it be cool if Ferris was imaginary and Cameron's just making this up?
Well, the idea that gives Cameron more of a.
Yeah.
Puts Cameron more in the forefront. I like that idea.
Yeah.
You know, I love Cameron. I love Cameron in this movie. Cameron was very, like I said.
You're a little biased toward Cameron. This is pretty
good. Like I said, it's really dawning on me now how much this movie affected me. I never really thought about it before tonight, but it really did affect me that I like complex, sensitive, neurotic boys more than I like super confident boys. It's bizarre how that happened.
Yeah, I understand that. So, of course, this isn't just an exercise in what ifs. He says, he adds, one must love Matthew Broderick, War Games, this movie, Glory, Biloxi Blues, the producers, and recently a piece of shit on the Connors TV show.
He was such an asshole on the Connors TV show. Oh my God. He was.
Yeah. Watched that. So you probably know about it.
I do watch it. Yeah. He was, Jackie's boyfriend.
Okay.
But he really took advantage of her and he wound up cheating on her. He was either, like a doctoral student or teaching and not making a lot of money and sort of living off of Jackie. And he wound up really mooching off of her, but he wound up cheating on her also. And then when she confronted him, he like blamed her for being neurotic. So he was a horrible character and you were really happy when she kicked him to the curb.
Okay. Well, I haven't seen it since it came back. So, and I'll take your word for it. All right. He adds, he lives a lifetime in this movie, becoming an icon to teens at that time. I mean, I was a teen in those years, class of 86. So Dave, I'm class of 87. So Dave's a year ahead of me. Alan Ruck, Captain Harriman of the USS Enterprise B, need I say more? Jennifer Grey, yes please. Red Dawn, Dirty Dancing, and recently on the Connors. So she was also on the Connors recently? Interesting. Best triple snap heel kick in the movie since Bruce Lee.
Oh, for sure.
Right?
For sure.
Charlie Sheen, Platoon alone makes him a legend. I could watch this movie every day of the week and twice on Sunday. Great choice, and now I have another podcast. Yay. I see what you did there. Thanks, David K. Proctor. So thank you, Dave.
Thanks for listening, Dave.
Yeah, thanks for checking us out, and thanks for supporting us. And hopefully you stick around for our future movies. So great to hear from you. So everybody, if you want to be like Dave, and please do, write to us at drunkcinemapodcast@gmail.com. That's drunkcinemapodcast@gmail.com. Or you can reach us on the Twitter machine at Drunk Cinemacast or at Drunk Cinema on Facebook. So check us out there. Please like and follow us and share our links and stuff, because that would help people find us. Since we're, I have to yell over Xan's packaging.
I'm sorry. It's jelly beans. They're really, really good.
So yeah, it helps people find us, and obviously since we're a new podcast, this is only
episode
2.
Only when you're
drunk
does 99-cent food like taste like the most delicious,
the best
food
ever. Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, I don't know. We're still working out. Yeah, yeah. It's 99 cents, and it's the best food ever. Oh, Charles, I wonder if Chris will take me to Taco Bell. That'd be amazing.
I'm sure he would do it. He'll do whatever you ask, I'm sure.
Yeah, he probably would.
He probably would.
Yeah, just to keep me from driving myself.
Well, you shouldn't be driving right now, probably.
No.
Don't drive.
Don't drive.
Don't drink and drive. We don't encourage that here. Even though we're drunk cinema, we encourage drinking at home, not drinking while driving.
Right. Yeah. Heck yeah, drinking at home.
So,
and then getting your spouse to drive you for shitty food.
Yeah. So, Xan, where can they reach you in the meantime?
I don't. No, Charles. What am I? Udinex 19?
Yeah,
shit like that.
Yeah, that sounds good. Udinex 19 at Twitter.
Yeah, Udinex 19 on the Twitter and the Instagram, and Xan Sprouse on the Facebook. What about you, Charles?
Of course, for me, at Charles Skaggs on Twitter, at Charles Skaggs on Facebook, and at Charles Skaggs on Instagram, and my blog and geeky things.
Damn good coffee. And hot.
Damn good coffee and hot.
Oh, yeah.
Where I talk about all the stuff we talk about here on Drunk Cinema. So, your Batman 1989, Ferris Bueller, all kinds of movie news. News of my other podcasts that I do for Southgate Media, including Next Stop Everywhere, the Doctor Who podcast, where Dave writes in and occasionally Xan shows up, only albeit more sober. And Jesse Jackson and the Sword of Special Guest Companions and I talk all kinds of Doctor Who, Torchwood, Sarah Jane Adventures, and more. And I hope everybody checks that out. And then the Phantom Zone podcast that I do with DJ Nick, where currently we've got 2 episodes left to go talking The Boys Season 2. And that's been a lot of fun. Dave writes in there as well. And then Ghost with the Twin Peaks podcast that I do with a certain Xan Sprouse. Maybe you've heard of her.
More sober.
Yeah. Where right now we're trying to figure out when we can record our Criterion Collection commentary.
We'll do it next week.
Drill down of The Elephant Man, David Lynch's film.
Yeah, we'll do it next week.
Yeah. Oh, by the way, did you hear that today they announced that David Lynch has a new TV?
Yes, I did. Oh, my God. Wisteria, baby.
I posted it on our Ghostwood page if anybody's curious.
I know. I saw that you posted. I was about to post it on Ghostwood, and I saw that you beat me to it because I've been asleep all day because today was record store day, and I got up really early.
I took advantage of that. Yeah. All right. Yeah. So I hope everybody checks us out on Ghostwood, because obviously if you enjoy what we do here, you got to check us out on Ghostwood because we have a ball there as well, obviously, because
we do.
This is the podcast that spawned Drunk Cinema. So why not?
I know,
right? You got to do it. Got to check us out. So next time on Drunk Cinema.
Yippee-ki-yay, motherfucker,
because right now we're going to be heading into the holiday season, and what better way to celebrate the holidays
together? We'll have a few laughs
with the ultimate Christmas movie, Die Hard.
Die Hard.
Yes.
It was December 24th on Hollis Ave in the park.
Yeah, break out the Run DMC, have Argyle Brie out the limo, and say hi to Special Agent Johnson.
No relation.
Yeah. And
make fists with your toes.
Yeah. Get ready to break into a safe in Nakatomi Plaza or Nakatomi Tower in Nakatomi Plaza.
Mm-hmm.
So, go buy Officer Al some Twinkies, because we're going to be talking Die Hard.
Because remember, when you steal $600, you can just disappear. But when you steal $600 million, they will find you unless they think you're already dead.
It's Christmas.
So, it's the time for miracles, Theo.
It's the time, Theo, yes. So, yeah, everybody, we're going to be doing that. So it's going to be a lot of fun. I think everybody loves Die Hard. It's Christmas time. What better time for us to talk about this movie? And I'm looking forward to this one a lot. a lot because I'm a big diehard guy, so I love that.
I'm a big Die Hard fan too. Die Hard is literally my favorite Christmas movie, and Charles, I think we should probably, the way our schedule works, we would be recording on Christmas Eve, and I think we should take that night off.
Well, you know, it's still, that would be like a month away. We could record before that. We could record in just 2 weeks.
I guess we could, but yeah, you know, I feel like we should take Christmas Eve off.
Okay, we'll take Christmas Eve.
I'm gonna be drunk, but I'll be with my husband.
I understand. Yeah. That's okay. We will take that Christmas Eve off. Yes.
Yeah, we deserve a night off. We will have done 3 episodes, Charles. We deserve a day off.
This is too much for us. Exactly.
I know. That's a lot. That's a lot to do. It's a lot of work. It's a lot of drinking. My liver needs a day off.
Yeah, probably. Probably.
Yeah.
So, it's good. So, hope everybody comes back for that. And if you have any suggestions about movies you'd like us to cover here in Drunk Cinema, drop us a line at the Drunk Cinema Podcast at Gmail. We'd love to hear from you.
The Gmail.
And Xan, do you have any final thoughts before we sign off? I guess not.
Not really.
Not really. No. Okay. On that rather anticlimactic note.
You know what?
Note,
if you're going to... I'm going to just give some advice, okay? If you're going to get drunk, just order pizza in advance.
There you go.
Because you're going to want it, especially when you see it in a movie.
And don't forget the gummy bears.
Gummy bear.
They're real warm and soft.
They're real warm. They've been in my pocket, so they're real warm and soft.
All right.
I've never smelled a real school bus before.
All right. So, everybody, thank you so much for listening, and we'll see you next time on Drunk Cinema. Bye, everybody.
Bye, everybody. Dumb.